Good evening. We have fancy new, from FCAT, fancy new recording here tonight. So welcome to the Town of Deerfield Selectboard meeting on June 28th, 2016 at 6:33 in the evening. We're going to just bump up Mary Ellen, who has come up from Waitley, for, and it will take 2 seconds. She has presented us with the Board, South County EMS Board of Oversight's recommendation to reject all the bids submitted for the RFP, all the responses. There was no acceptable response to the RFP, and the Board of Oversight is confident that the Select Board to Deerfield as a fiscal agent will move forward to negotiate a place, permanent place, for the South County EMS. So I will take a motion to reject.
I'll make a motion to reject both RFPs, or the RFPs, both submittals.
I'll second the motion.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you so much for coming, and we will, you have Kip's phone number,
right,
and we will move forward.
Okay, great.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. Just to be clear, what is the board moving forward with?
We are moving forward with trying to find a permanent housing for the South County EMS.
Okay.
And we will have discussions with Waitley and entertain other proposals. Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, we're going to skip over our minutes because we are just a little bit late. Is Matt Gilmore here? Well,
we can do our minutes.
We can do our minutes, I guess. And then we'll move into our public hearing. We have minutes from June 22nd, June 15th.
I've read them. Good?
Yes.
I've read them.
Okay.
Yep.
I make a motion that we accept the minutes.
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
Mm-hmm.
Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay. Senior Center Operations Update. Do we have anyone here for that? Doug, do you have any information on
that? Actually, the expectation was that both Sarah Woodbury from the library and Marlene Johnson from the Senior Center would be here at about 7:30. I was anticipating
okay.
that the public hearing would start at 6:30.
Mm. Okay. I know Barbara is very anxious about this, so why don't we jump down to Assistant Town Clerk
okay.
appointment?
Mm-hmm.
You received your packets.
Yes.
Okay.
Did you want to take a look, or have you already?
Oh, yeah. No, I did.
Okay. Well, I'd make a motion to accept the recommendation to hire Michelle Barden as the position for the assistant, administrative assistant, assistant town clerk, grade one, step one.
I'll second the motion.
Do you have any further discussions?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
The name is Michelle Barden.
Well, let's go on to our regular appointments.
Okay.
How do you guys want to do this? We could read the names for each committee. We'll give Matt another. We'll do our appointments, and we'll vote on the approval for the roof.
Okay.
Actually, let's do the approval for the roof right now.
Okay.
And then we'll interrupt our appointments, hopefully. Matt will show up. So I make a motion to approve Kip Camosa as our authority for the Deerfield Elementary Roof Project.
I second that.
You would have the ability to, what do we want to say, Doug, that he has the ability to do the change order sign-offs?
What was requested by the building committee was to have a member of the select board have the authority, have this board delegate the authority to one person to approve change orders and to participate in the building committee meetings, which happen weekly, or at least be available on a regular basis to be able to approve those change orders.
Okay, because we had already appointed Kip to the building committee.
Right. So as long as you're appointing him as your delegate in order to approve change orders.
So we are giving him the authority for the change order and review.
My strong recommendation would be to provide a limit on that authority. Don't take offense, Kip. but after thinking about it, this is just my own thoughts, that he has approval to approve change orders that do not extend the deadline for substantial completion or that increase the cost of the project by either a certain dollar figure or a certain percentage.
I wouldn't do it anyways. If it was going to increase anything, I would have a discussion with you guys anyways.
Right, exactly.
I have no idea what kind of change orders would be anticipated, but say $10,000?
Regardless of what it was, I would contact you guys. Even if we had to get together for a special time.
Well, I mean, the whole point of this was to avoid...
To avoid delays.
And yeah, I understand. Because...
The violations of open meeting
We could call another meeting if we needed to, if it was that crucial, but I don't anticipate anything like that, so...
Okay, well... I am perfectly comfortable not putting a dollar limit on it, we have to post it for 48 hours. It has to be, has to be agenda item. I mean, we don't want to, it will cost us money if this roof isn't completed.
I understand, but as the job would progress, it isn't like
everything stops. You know what you could do? You could have Dick call us, and then it's not a violation of open meeting law.
Hi.
Thanks.
Or Doug.
But Dick will be at the meeting, so if...
And I plan on attending.
Good.
So, yeah. Wonderful.
Between you and Dick, we would be able to...
There's already, I think, three change orders that are being considered, the price of which may range anywhere from $1,000 to upwards of $8,000 or $9,000 each, although I'll defer to Dick Kalaszewski as to the heat exchanger and in the ventilation system. I'm not sure what that would cost, but I know there's two smaller change orders in relation to outside repairs that have been requested. It's smaller dollar amounts. The HVAC repair may exceed $10,000.
Well, the discussion I had today was one of those AC units was fairly new, only a couple years old, and I was going to ask the engineer tomorrow why he felt necessary to replace something that was only 2 years old.
Okay.
And if he didn't investigate, I want to know why he didn't. But those are the things I'm going to watch, and just to make sure that they're not just going ahead and doing.
Absolutely.
Like,
Fair enough.
Yeah.
So I guess I feel comfortable not putting a dollar limit on.
Just
have conversation, you and Dick. Just calling Trevor and I, and that way we're not. But open meeting, there's no open meeting violations, and there's no, and we won't have any impact on the schedule because they're already late starting.
For the record, my expectation will be to take I assume that Kip will be doing communication with Richard, and of course we'll be participating in the building committee. My communication to the other two members of the board will be for information purposes, not to deliberate, or to second guess, but just to make sure that you're kept in the loop.
Yeah.
And I'm happy to do that.
Great. So that's fine.
That'd be
that's
great,
fine.
Doug. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you for doing that.
So you made a motion. I second.
Okay. Then all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Why don't you abstain?
I'll abstain.
So two in favor, one abstention.
Yep.
Okay. We're going to start this hearing. We're going to go start our appointments, and if Matt is not here by another 10 minutes or so, we'll take comment from the neighborhood, okay? You all came, and I appreciate that, and you have concerns, and I feel like, we have a police officer here. We've had staff over at the site, so... We'll have a semi-public hearing, but we will make no decisions, I guess. Okay.
Do you want to do the reserve fund? Or you wanted to go to appointments?
Yeah, let's do appointments, because we can stop in the appointments.
Right. Sure.
At any point, we can stop the appointments.
Wait a few more minutes.
If Matt comes.
Okay.
Okay. Do you want to read the committee and mm-hmm. then who one of you can make?
Sure.
Okay.
Well, we'll start at the top, the Agricultural Commission. We have Stephen Taylor, Francis Sobieski, Peter Melnick, Thomas Clark, Kenneth Williams, and John Baronis. I don't see requesting reappointment.
I don't think that Kenneth Williams is on that board anymore.
Yeah,
I do believe he's moved out of town.
Okay.
And no one had...
And nobody has
No one
requested.
Responded, Doug?
The only responses we received were from where you see an X in the third column on the right.
Okay.
We got an affirmative that there were individuals wanting to serve or continue to serve in those positions. Otherwise, we did not get a response from any. There's some exceptions, like the Board of Health agents. We're going to assume they want to stay employed. Yeah. So,
yes.
Kathy, do you know if Peter wants to continue? All right.
The Agricultural Commission.
I understand what it is, but did you send a letter?
We tried to contact the
phone call,
the chair of the committee, and ask them to reach out to people. And we did not hear back from anybody.
All right. Well, let's. I do know that Tom Clark's on vacation right now, but
yeah.
I know that he's interested. So
okay.
Let's go ahead and appoint them, but not. I do
Kenneth.
Think Sandy is out of town now, so most of the time. So we'll not mm-hmm. appoint Sandy or Kenneth Williams.
Kenneth Williams. Okay.
Is Chip,
is Chip, Chip lives in Greenfield.
That was his son.
And, oh, was
that
it
was,
Chip?
Yes.
Okay.
It was Chip.
Oh, okay. I thought it was Sandy. Cause,
no, it's Chip.
Okay. There's no Roman numeral on this. It just says Kenneth Williams. Okay. Well, Chip can't serve because he's out of town. He's moved
right.
to Greenfield. Okay.
So would I make a motion?
Yeah.
I'll make a motion to approve people listed for the Agricultural Commission.
I'll second the motion.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
So the Americans with Disabilities Coordinator would be Kevin Scarborough.
Okay.
I make a motion to elect our...
Oh, you just have to second it.
I'll second it.
Is there any more discussion? You know what? Instead, we'll just let's just list them because this will take forever.
And then we'll do a
yeah.
final vote. Tally.
As you go through, I'm keeping track. And
right. okay, so
yeah.
Trevor, just read them, and
okay.
then we'll just vote everybody.
Board of Health agents: Richard Kalaszewski, Valerie Bird, Kevin Scarborough, Zachary Smith. I may kill some of these names.
Oh, David Zamoyski.
David Zamoyski. I think that's it for
yep.
Board of Agents. Building Commissioner, Richard Kalaszewski. Building Inspector, Kyle Scott. Burial Agent, Barbara Hancock. Cable Advisory Committee would be Paul Alice and Mark Gilmore. CIPC, Carolyn Ness. Let's see. A Civil Defense Emergency Manager, Mark Gilmore, Zachary Smith. Community Preservation Commission would be Rachel Blaine. Conservation Commission would be Louis Massoon, Benjamin Byrne. The Cultural Council would be Julie Cavaco, Piper Pichette, Candace Bradbury Carlin, and we go on to DEDIC. Which would be Robert Decker, Ralph Healy, Richard Andreoli, Deerfield Historical Commission, Benita Collin, David Driver, and Henrietta Cocott, Deerfield PD Crossing Guard, Henrietta Cocott, Diane Baronis. Emergency 911 coordinator would be Chester Yazwinski and William Swayze. Energy Resource Committee would be David Gilbert Keith, Irene Clancy, Mark Gilmore, Jennifer Marapisi, Jay Stryker, Irene Winkelbauer, and Stephen Eiper. Fence viewers We've got Franklin Sherburn. Forest Wardens would be Thomas Clark, Kevin Scarborough, William Swayze, and Chester Yuzwinski. Franklin County Solid Waste Committee, M.A. Swedland and Mark Gilmore. Franklin County Transit Authority Rep would be Robert Decker. FERCOG Rep would be Carolyn Shores Ness. Gas and Plumbing Inspector, Stephen Baranowski. Hazardous Waste Coordinator, Lynn Rose. Highway Department Director, Kevin Scarborough. Keeper of the Cemetery Maps, Kevin Scarborough. Keeper of the Clock, Robert Ouellette. Local Census Director would be Barbara Hancock. Open Space Committee, we have John Knurr, Lynn Rose, Marie Gwynn, Gurin?
Oh, that's for the personnel.
Oh, that's Personnel Board. I'm sorry. Thought it went over. Personnel Board, Marie Gwynn, Nancy Schwartz. Recreation Committee, we have Robert Ackerman, Beth Brown, Jeff Galley, Charles Knight, Rodney Warnick, Eileen Skrabisky, and Rebecca Zoli.
Yep.
Let's see. And then Register of Voters, we have Barbara Hancock, Joanne Carney, Patricia Kroll, and William Lino. SCEMS Board of Oversight, we have Trevor McDaniel and Kip Camosa. Survey of Lumber and Wood would be Kevin Scarborough. SWIM Program Committee will be Judith Bardwell and Bethany Foley. Town Council will be Blattman, Bobrowski, and Mead, LLC. Town Council Clifford and Kenny, LLE. Tree Warden and Moth Superintendent, Kevin Scarborough. Fred Wells W. Trust, or Fred W. Wells Trust, Fund Trust, Trustee would be Henry Zukowski. Wiring Inspector would be Wayne Shaw. Workers Unemployment Compensation Agent, Barbara Hancock and Sarah Masuin.
That's Mission.
What's it?
Mission.
And I should know that. Zoning Board of Appeals, Robert Bohonowitz, Linda Dumas, Robert Decker. Regional Services, FERCOG, and Town Nurse, FCCPHS.
Well, that's going to be Kip.
Kip, okay.
Yeah, Henry
Kip
Camosa.
Yep. Which one was that?
Not the Town Nurse.
As the Town Nurse, you do delegate that authority to the Frank County Community Public Health Service.
Right, but Kip is going to be on the...
Kip will be the representative to that.
On the health services,
on the Zoning Board of Appeals, it should say Ronald, not Robert.
Oh,
yes.
That
is an error.
It should say Ron?
Ron
Bohonowitz.
Yes.
Thank you.
I apologize. I thought that spelling mistake was corrected.
So to the FERCOG, or the Franklin County Health Public Health District, we're appointing you.
Okay.
I know you are wild for that one.
So,
okay.
So on the back, we have...
Well, you told me that Dick also did that, so...
Yes. Dick, you're going to go with Dick.
Richard, on the public health, regional health district?
Dick is the alternate.
Okay.
So that we always have a vote. We have always voted a select board member. It's supposed to be a select board member, but Dick is always there as our alternate.
Okay.
So that we have a vote.
May I recommend that you take a vote on the names and the appointments you've just read?
Okay.
You have to second that.
Excuse me.
Sure.
These are new appointments. Is that what the list was that you just read?
Yes.
Okay, Marie Warren is no longer on the personnel board, just for clarification.
Thank
Her
you.
Term ended in May.
Okay.
And she did not want to do it because... Because it said here that she did ask to do it.
Yeah,
no, she didn't.
You do have an X next to that. So
yes.
That's confusing. But she did resign.
Yes, she did
this
resign.
Past month. Okay.
Correct.
So, for which the...
So,
and we have a new member that you did not mention, Karen Marr.
Yeah, that person will be mentioned in the next section. We've got about another 15 names.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Yeah, I was looking for her to make sure
okay.
she was there.
I make a motion that we approve those names, minus Marie's, Gurren's name for the Personnel Committee.
Oh.
And correcting Ron Bohanowicz's name to Ronald.
And adding Kip Kamosa and Richard Kalaszewski as
right.
an alternate.
Second? Second?
No, you made the motion.
Oh,
I second it.
Oh, I thought you seconded.
You just said.
Okay. If there's no more discussion, let's say. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. We do have vacancies, and we have some additional appointments. We have a vacancy for the Cable Advisory Committee, the Conservation Commission, and we have two seats available or positions available for the Cultural Council.
The individuals listed in your right-hand column are people that have been either actively, who have actively sought those seats, or who have been put there by the chairs of those various committees as people who have expressed interest and are willing to serve.
Right.
So when you have alternates, just to for clarification here, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 alternates. Is this alternates for the Cultural Council?
The Cultural Council has 5 seats. They want to have the additional members appointed so they can participate in activities, but they would not be voting members.
Okay.
There's 9 of them.
Okay.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Do you have more than I do on the Cultural Council?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8 total
people.
Okay. 2
seats and then 6 alternates. All right. So, Trevor, why don't you make a motion?
Okay. I move to appoint to the Cultural Council in seat 4, Roberta LaBarbera. And seat 5 would be Jennifer Marapisi. Alternate, John, the rest are alternates. We have John Altman, Kevin Kelly, Gretchen Law, Olivia Leone, Carolyn McBurney, and Lou Vincent.
Okay. I second that. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. We have a new appointment for the DDIC board,
mm-hmm.
John Prosperi. Yep. I make a motion to appoint him.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 A quick note, that seat is one that's reserved for a representative who will represent low or moderate income residents in town. John, to his own regrets, meets those criteria. This is a position which normally would be filled by the board, appointed by the board, from 3 people recommended by the Regional Housing Authority. We did reach out to the Regional Housing Authority and explained this appointment, but we did not get a list of 3 names back from them, and John agreed to serve. So,
This has been vacant for years and years.
Since it started, yeah.
Yeah, so this is good. We have a vacancy on the Historical Commission. We have a nomination of Skip Olmstead to a fence viewer with Frank Sherburn.
Mm-hmm.
I make that motion for Skip.
I'll second it.
Any further discussion?
Mm-hmm.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We have a vacancy on the Franklin Solid Waste Committee. And we have an appointment. Here's the appointment for Karen Morrill on the
Personnel Board.
I make a motion to appoint Karen Morrill for the Personnel Board.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. The SCEMS Board of Oversight Fiscal Agent.
Karen.
I better not. You can appoint.
I move to appoint Carolyn Nest to the SCEMS Board of Oversight Fiscal Agent.
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
I'll abstain. There is a swim program committee seat available.
And an open space committee.
And the open space committee. We have Tri-Town Beach commission seat available. John Siz has volunteered to be the Veterans Grave Officer. I make a motion to appoint him.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And we have a Zoning Board of Appeals alternate that is also available. So there's, let me just run over this again if anyone is interested. We have a Cable Advisory Committee seat available. We have a Conservation Commission seat available. We have a Historic Commission seat available. We have a Solid Waste Committee seat available and Open Space Committee seat available. We have Swim Program Committee seat available and a Tri-Town Beach Commission seat available, as well as an alternate to the Zoning Board of Appeals. So if anyone is interested, especially the Conservation Commission, it is a little bit of work, but it's hugely important to our town. Okay, given the fact that it's almost 7 o'clock, and this was a 6:35 public hearing announcement, I think, well, I don't want to speculate, so. Yes, I'm going to. Yes. Oh, well, okay, Dick, go ahead. So I was going to.
Yes.
I see the plaintiff, or petitioner, is not here. This has been a 2-year ongoing problem. It's been dealing with the DEP, dealing with the property people, dealing with the neighbors. Sorry, I'm not mad at you real quick, but it's gone on long enough. I heard you say earlier you take this under advisement. What I would like to have happen here, because this has gone on so long and there's so many chances, and I bent over backwards for this so many times, I would like you to listen to these neighbors, listen to their comments, and then I would like you to make a decision. My decision would be to deny the permit and send Mr. Gilmore a letter, and the letter with a time factor of X number of days with a fine attached for non-compliance. Until you do that, I have no enforcement ability. And I'm sorry that I can't help any of you people, because that's where the buck stops, is right here today. I think delaying this, postponing it, is inexcusable.
Thank you, Dick. I will call this public hearing to, well, I'll open this public hearing, I guess, at 7 o'clock tonight. This was supposed to be a business home business permit application for Matthew Gilmore at 72 Mill Village Road, South Deerfield. I do want to welcome everyone here. I just want to say a few words before we start, is that I hope everyone has a chance to speak, but we are a lovely and gracious community, so try not to clap. And since Matt isn't here, there's no booing, but we just need to be civil and make your complaints as part of the public record. I know I've spoken to numerous neighborhood people, and I certainly understand your frustration, and we will listen to what you have to say, and we take it to heart, because I know people are very upset. This has, as Dick alluded, this has been a very long, ongoing situation. So we'd like to hear what you have to say.
I have the list. If folks have not yet signed in, please come up and sign in. We'll go in order of appearance on the list. Those of you who did not indicate that you wish to speak, I'll be skipping over your names. Feel free to raise your hand once we've gone through the list if you'd like to speak, starting with Timothy Gaczynski, Mill Village Road. Please step up, have a seat in front of the mic. Thank you.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
Tim, could you just reintroduce yourself for the record? Thank you.
My name is Timothy Gaczynski. I'm a butter of Mr. Gilmore, number 74 Mill Village Road, my wife Joanne. And I'd like to commend Mr. Kalicheski for his efforts, and I'm with him. I think a decision should be made tonight. I think the group, the community as a whole, you've been really patient. It's been 2.5 years.
Okay.
And I had 3 bullet points that I wanted to go over real quick. I'll make it within 2 minutes. We oppose any type of business permits on Mill Village Road, any at all. My big concern is the degradation of my property value. I think it's gone down. I've had town officials tell me, even if I wanted your house, you couldn't give it to me with that eyesore next door. You go up and down Mill Village Road, it's a nice community, it's a nice road, there's farms, there's nice homes, and you've got this eyesore right in the middle. I asked Mr. Gilmore 2 years ago when he moved in. He did indicate to me that he was going to have some trucks there. And I said, why don't you put up a big stockade fence, keep everything out back, keep it clean, neat, and orderly, and present it well. Fell on deaf ears. Never heard a word. He never did anything. Mr. Kalicheski can vouch for that. I, at my expense, had to put up a row of arborvitaes and other natural fencing to shield myself from that eyesore. I'm sorry I keep using that term, but that's what it is. And I'm sure all of you have seen it. My second point was that area is zoned, from what I understand, residential agricultural. And according to the Deerfield Code, there is no contractor's yard allowed. So I don't know how this could even be considered. Number three, Mr. Gilmore, in my estimation, has been running a contractor's yard for the last 2 years. There was a complaint filed in December of 2015. I'm not going to get into the whole chronological order, but it was over 120 days before he even responded to it. So he doesn't care. There's no respect for the neighborhood. There's no respect for the town. He does as he pleases. From the noise, the diesel fumes, there's late evening activity there with trucks coming in and out. There's personnel. And that's happened on the weekends, too. And there are four unregistered vehicles in that yard. And again, I didn't pull that number out of my hat. It's right here in Mr. Kalicheski's order. And there's debris, including stumps, old tires, and who knows whatever else there. And, you know, I'm asking you people, and I hope as my elected representatives, that you will take action and you will enforce and make Mr. Gilmore clean that property and make it whole again. That's all I have to say.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tim.
On the list next, Ms. Cheryl Daggett, 10B Boynton Road.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Hi. I'm Cheryl Daggett, and I am a member of the Board of Trustees of the Mountain View Condominium Association. Our association consists of 8 buildings and 15 families, and we are both immediate and secondary abutters to Mr. Gilmore's property. Many of our unit owners are in attendance this evening. It is the consensus of our unit owners that we as an association oppose Mr. Gilmore's application for a home business permit. The nature of his business, in our estimation, definitely is not compatible with the look and feel of a residential neighborhood. To our association, and especially to the unit owners living directly across the street from Mr. Gilmore's property, it is evident that some sort of business has been conducted on the 72 Mill Village Road property for more than 2 years. Over this time, it has been the noise, the fumes, and the destruction of the landscape that has upset us the most. The noises emanating from this property are heard during the work week and also on weekends. It consists of beeping of trucks and construction vehicles as they back up, the whine of vehicles idling for long periods of time, the loud clanking sound of trucks dumping loads of asphalt, concrete, dirt, stumps, and the like onto the property. The annoying noise of construction equipment moving this material across the site, and the whir of metalworking machinery used to grind, cut, and polish metal components. The noise begins as early as 5:30 a.m. It continues on and off throughout the day, and may not end until well into the evening, 11, 12 o'clock at night. These extended hours of operation make it difficult for the members of our association to enjoy their yards, their decks, and even the tranquility of their living rooms. For those who work, the early wake-up call affects them throughout their day. And for those unit owners who are home during the day, the noise is stressful and makes them anxious as they wait to see if it will begin again. Further health and safety concerns are the noxious fumes emanating from the idling trucks and the clouds of dust that are stirred up by the many vehicles and equipment being used to work on the property. Because of the activities on the site, field mice have been displaced and have ended up in our cellars and garages. Our association has concerns about the traffic onto the property and off the property, the speed with which some of the vehicles travel along our road, and the impossible impeding of emergency vehicles along Mill Village Road. The safety of children, of walkers, and of bicyclists should be a major concern here. Also, our association has concern about the decrease in our property values due to the destruction of the pristine nature of the area. With the arrival of a new neighbor, what had been an undeveloped field of natural beauty was transformed into a site that can now only be described as a dump or a junkyard, in essence, an ugly eyesore. Thus, we are all concerned that it will be more difficult to sell our homes if a business that is incompatible with the look and feel of a residential neighborhood becomes established within our midst. Regarding Mr. Gilmore's application, I do have the following questions. He did not indicate where specifically on the property the proposed home office and the storage for plowing equipment will be located. He also did not indicate where the proposed parking area for prospective clients of this construction will be. On his application, Mr. Gilmore indicates that he was granted a permit, which he still holds. Since the fee noted on Mr. Gilmore's application implies an initial home business permit, can the select board tell us what is the status of that other permit and what is its effect on this application? In conclusion, I really appreciate the opportunity to address the select board on behalf of the Mountain View Condominium Association and for being able to collectively state our reasons why we strongly oppose Mr. Gilmore's application for a home business permit. Unfortunately, a couple of weeks ago, one of our unit owners was verbally threatened. A complaint was filed with the South Deerfield Police Department, and I hope that the select board has seen it. We also hope that our individual unit owners and we as an association will not have to live in fear of retaliation for having come forward this evening. I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
As far as I know, and Doug, please jump in, the only thing that Mr. Gilmore has done is done a DBA doing business as filing with the town clerk, which is just, you know, you're registering your business and
nothing more. Is it temporary in nature?
It's not a permit to operate the business at all. It's just a registration of the business name.
All right. Thank you very much for explaining.
Just gives you a mailing address kind of thing. Okay. It's not any permit whatsoever.
Okay. Thank you.
Next on the list is Ms. Carol Crafts, 59 Mill Village Road.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Hi. I'm Carol Crafts, and I am a board member also over at the condominiums. And my little talk is going to be short and very
Carol,
sweet.
Could you just move your speaker just a little bit? You have a soft voice.
Right.
I just want to make sure that we get your everything recorded.
All right. It's short and sweet, my little talk. The peaceful tranquility of our neighborhood has disappeared. It has been replaced by the everyday shrill noises of construction equipment that pierce the air and offends our ears, to say nothing of the odorous diesel fumes that waft through our atmosphere, or the unsightly appearance of the property that is so offensive to our eyes and most likely diminishing our property values. I do not believe that there would be many residents of this town that could accept these daily infringements that have affected our lives so adversely for the past 2 years. And I also want to add that at the front end of this property, there are several pine trees which are all dead. I do believe that this happened when the earth was all removed and boulders were dropped on top of the roots of those trees, and then it was covered up with dirt. To me, the trees are beginning to look like they could be quite dangerous to people traveling that road or anything else that could happen if we happen to have a storm or anything. And I think something should be done. I don't know if the town department or who would look into that, but something should be done with those trees.
Actually, we'll have Kevin look at that.
Okay, thank That's you a good very point. Much for your time.
Thank you
thank
very
you.
Much.
Thank you very much.
The next name on the list, I cannot read the name. The address is 165 Pine Nook Road.
That's me. I don't want to speak on this issue. I'm sorry. I didn't realize that was specific.
Oh, okay. So you don't.
No.
And that's you. I'm sorry. I couldn't read your name. I apologize. No one else had expressed an interest in speaking. Bruce Hunter said maybe, so I left you for last.
Bruce Hunter, 103 St. Gully Road. Not in a direct abutter, but I pass by that piece of property on a daily basis. For the past year, that property has been in violation of the town's bylaw, Chapter 219, Article 1, dumping, and unlawful dumping 219-3. There is a fine attached to that. It has not been imposed. I wish it would be. There's also a requirement of a misdemeanor charge to be placed on the owner of the property, possibly taken to court. The bylaw is short in its potential charge. It's only $20 for the first violation. There's no charge for the second violation, but there is the option, I believe, for further grounds to be placed by the selectmen.
What was that you said?
Chapter 219, Section 219-3, unlawful dumping.
Okay.
The only place in Deerfield where you can dump is at the town landfill.
Well, we do have a Section 123-2. It talks about violations and penalties, and it talks about dumping. And it's a $25 fine for the first offense, $50 for the second offense, and $100 for each subsequent offense.
And I wish they would be, because there is currently concrete, boulders, wood. All this should be removed from the property, and I agree with the first speaker. That'd be brought back to its original state.
Thank you, Bruce.
Thank you very
Thanks.
Much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bruce. Kip and Trevor, do you have any questions of the neighbors?
No, I'm good.
No, I'm good.
Okay.
I apologize. I put a question on Noel's.
Oh,
store.
We'd love to hear.
Are you,
Noel? I promise I will not.
No, no, no,
please
no,
take
it's
your
fine.
Time.
It's
61A Mill Village Road.
Yes,
okay,
thank
I
you. My name is Noel. No, that's okay. I put the question on.
Sure. Thank you.
My name is Noel. I live at Mill Village Road, across the street, kind of angled to the property that we're all talking about. When we moved in, my father-in-law bought the place for us, and we ended up paying him off. I could guarantee you that my father-in-law checked to make sure that we weren't buying a place where businesses could just move in like that. Mm. I can guarantee it because I know where he lives in North Andover at the very far end of a cul-de-sac way out in the woods. So I know that as an investment, Mr. Hall wasn't going to buy a place where anytime down the road, somebody could have a construction site, basically, or contractor's yard, however you want to say it. And I feel that now that this has occurred, this is kind of like the cart before the horse. Like, I don't understand what we're even doing here. It's already been happening for 2 years, and now he's asking for a permit for a home office? In what building? In the outside building where he makes all the noise, or the inside building? Like, fine, you can live, work at your house, that's fine. But what's going on there has been going on for 2 years, and now we're having this meeting. To me, the answer is no, thank you, tried. And also, it's almost an hour past when it was supposed to be. I saw the gentleman get into his truck and leave with this 5:30, quarter after five. I assumed he was coming here. But he's not here. Mm. So that should show you that he doesn't really care what you think.
I know.
And to me, that would bother me. If I was sitting there, that would bother me. That I had called this. And I mean, we had to go to the post office to pick up the letter, you know, like it was an important thing. This is a big deal. He didn't show up. and he asked after 2 years of doing it. So I would ask you please to just take that into consideration and think about, like, if it was your kid who went and did something and then asked you permission 2 months after they had the party. So I appreciate your time, and thank you very much.
Thank you very
much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I do want to reiterate that we have spent staff time. Dick has been there multiple times. We have spent, Kevin has been there with BACO, when we had DEP there to do an inspection. There has been multiple visits by Dick. You know, all of us have spent time there. So there has been, and it's our office time, so there has been investment by the town to try to get this corrected. So I know you all are very frustrated, and that's why this is moving forward.
There's one additional name with a question mark next to it. Wayne Manley, 93 Mill Village Road. Did you wish to speak?
I think everything pretty much covered. The only...
Wayne, why don't you come up? It's okay.
Please.
This is pretty informal. We're not going to bite.
I'm Wayne Manley from 93 Mill Village Road. We go by the property every day. We've steadily watched the degradation of that property. I feel very sorry for the folks that live right across the road from that and look at it directly every day and next to it. Some things I know that there's been some violations Dick has issued there, and I'm looking at section 5100, article 5, section 5100.
I don't know.
In particular, 5130, the penalties for violations on the town bylaws.
Is that a zoning bylaw that you're looking at?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, it's very obvious if you go into the definitions within the town bylaws that he is operating a contractor's yard. Hmm. Let's see, that's... I can give you the page numbers and everything here. Chapter 179, page 82, definition of contractor's yard, shall mean premises used by a building contractor or subcontractor for storage of equipment and supplies, fabrication of subassemblies, and parking of wheeled or portable equipment. All of those have taken place at this site. I mean, there's no way he can deny that he's operating a contractor's yard on that site. And that's totally in violation of the town bylaws in a residential agricultural area. And the penalties, it said it shall be $300 for each offense, and each day that each violation continues constitutes a separate offense. This has been going on for God knows how long. So, you know, you folks need to back Dick up. You really do.
I know.
Because this can't continue. We have people come to our house from out of town. They'll come and they say, what is that going on down the road from your house? How does a town let that happen? It's embarrassing. It's embarrassing as a citizen. I've worked with some people from Shelburne and from Bernardston, and they've asked me the same thing. They said, what is going on there? So please, we're asking you just enforce the town bylaws that are in place. We're not asking magic. We're just asking, please enforce what's in place. That's all I can say.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks. Madam Chairman, no other individual stated their interest in speaking or even put a question mark next to it, I don't believe. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak who otherwise indicated?
Sure.
Would you like to? Please step up.
Thank you.
I just want to say I'm Joanne Gochinski, 74 Mill Village, and one thing that I can't get out of my head was 2 years ago, we set up an Easter egg hunt for my three granddaughters on the side of the house and everything else. And he had his diesel truck backed up towards our yard. And we had to move. The kids are out there coughing and saying how much it stinks and everything else. We had to move our Easter egg hunt. It was a family thing in their little dresses, just because of the fumes. And it just makes me angry. And I don't want that to happen again.
Right.
They shouldn't have to breathe.
I agree.
That air. They shouldn't have to listen to that noise. I watch them. They come over the house weekly, 2-3 days a week. Mm-hmm. And they got to listen to clanging and banging. They don't even enjoy being outside a lot. And I'm tired of it. You know, my home should be safe for them to breathe the air and have fun and play outside without having to worry about any of that. I just had to get that off my chest.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bruce.
Before the comment?
Sure.
Bruce Hunter, 103 San Gully Road. I believe that the residents and the abutters need clarification from the Board of Selectmen why it took 2 years to get to this point and why the bylaws of Deerfield were not upheld. And why the situation is only coming tonight. Thank you.
You want to try that one? You want to leave me to do it?
Go ahead.
Well, if you folks don't know me, I'm kind of brutally honest, but I would suspect that the reason that this has been going on for so long is because the person who applied for it, his father actually owns the property, and his father has been a former selectman in the town for several years. And I think the board or everybody involved kept getting, you know, pushed aside or excused or whatever, and it's intolerable. It never should have gone on that long, but it did. And for whatever point I have, I'm sorry for that. But we're going to, or at least I'm going to do my best to bring it to an end.
I just want to say, you know, most of our enforcement is to try to get compliance and make things safe. Certainly having the diesel trucks idle is a public health issue and is not safe.
Can I elaborate on that a little?
Yeah.
Madam.
Okay. I've had some conversation with our chief of police, and the motors running for more than 5 consecutive minutes is a violation of Chapter 90, Section 61A. I believe that's the correct one. And if any of you call the police department when you notice this vehicle or any vehicle or any engine or anything running for more than 5 minutes, the police will show up at the property and they will issue a citation for $100. Every time they're called thereafter, the law allows them to fine $500 for each thing. That doesn't go through the town, that goes through the DMV. And if Mr. Gilmore doesn't pay those fines, then I believe he might have a right to an appeal, but he could eventually lose his license to drive a motor vehicle and his registrations would be revoked. There's other things that play.
I mean, Dick is here. He will attest to the fact that he has been diligent, trying to get compliance and trying to get resolution, and I think we are all at the end of our rope here, not just the neighborhood, but Dick too. Would you like to comment on that, Dick? We have been putting effort into this. This is not, we have not been ignoring your complaints and your concerns. I mean, these are legitimate concerns, and they have not been ignored.
Let me make a little bit different statement. What happens is it falls short on doing an enforcement on such an obvious thing. People are just going to do this every single place in town. And I think everybody remembers Big Farmer scenario. It cost us thousands and thousands of dollars to get it under control, okay, which, and it took years. I mean, I just think that we need to be consistent. We need to follow protocol. I am very upset that I talked to Mr. Gilmore and I emphasized how important this was to try to negotiate with the selectmen and the neighbors, and then he doesn't show up. Really upset me. So my scenario again is I would like to see Mr. Gilmore, something generated to him saying you failed to show up at your hearing, and if you don't do this by this date, that this is the what is going to happen. Okay. Kip's statements earlier had some bearing to it. I made several attempts to communicate with both parties, and they made promises that they didn't keep. And it was promise after promise after promise. I have another situation that if we ignore this much longer, it will destroy some of the goodwill we have with the DEP. The DEP specifically turned this over to me and the town of Deerfield to resolve the large concrete pieces and blacktop pieces. And they gave us a time frame. They've bent over backwards for us. And it took us years to get that DEP scenario, as Carolyn and everybody should well know, to deal with the landfill. Yeah. And now we have a good relationship with them. And I would hate to see that go down the drain also. And that's what will happen if something doesn't happen, because the DEP is well aware of this hearing. And they are just waiting for some kind of response before they take action. And they've done a site visit recently, 2 weeks ago, they were on that site reviewing it. So, and they were well aware that there was a hearing tonight, and they'll be looking for answers. So, I hate to be the person that says you need to do something, but you need to take some affirmative action.
One of the reasons we hadn't pursued the court situation earlier is because it's very cumbersome, it's very expensive, and it doesn't necessarily, you would think that you have a pretty good case and you would win, but it is not necessarily true. And Dick and I have many months of experience working with Stanley Romanoski on that court scenario, and it did cost us thousands and thousands of dollars, although we did get some resolution. It's just you can't legislate neat and tidiness. What we can do is address the actual violations, and certainly we have a list of violations that, as Dick has alluded, we have bent over backwards to try to work and get compliance and resolve these situations. So I think there's frustration all the way around. And yes, Michelle.
I'm certainly one to offer goodwill, and I think that's fine and great, but I think you need to reflect on the language of your bylaws. The two important legal terms are shall impose or may impose or shall. And if it says shall, that's it. You have to follow through.
Do you have any questions? We can close the hearing. Left?
I have one additional comment.
Sure.
Go ahead.
It does say shall in the article bylaw chapter 219. And it also provides for declaration of public nuisance for dumping. And I think that's at least at a minimum that needs to be tonight declared public nuisance, so the penalties and violations can start as of this evening.
Do you have any questions of anybody?
No.
Okay.
No.
Then we'll close the hearing right now so we can deliberate. Doug, what time is it? Is it 7:32?
7:33.
We'll close the hearing. Okay.
If I may.
Yes.
The public hearing was held for the purpose of considering at-home business application. My strong recommendation to you is to dispose of that matter, and then if you're going to take any other further actions, I would just advise that we make sure that we're stepping on solid ground. The first time I've heard of declaration of a public nuisance, and I don't have the bylaws in front of me, but I don't know if the person impacted has to be present or has to be. I don't know. I simply don't know. So,
do you want to dispose of the matter first?
Yes.
And just deny
yes.
I make a motion that we deny the application for a home.
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Please make that unanimous.
As far as the public nuisance, the nuisance, I shouldn't say public nuisance, I've read that Dick has written and served upon Mr. Gilmore several registered letters, and Mr. Gilmore, I only found one response months after the fact. And according to the Mass General Law 111, Section 123, as long as they're given notice, the fines can start within a 24-hour period up to $1,000 each day. I don't feel comfortable at this time to put a dollar value on it, but I have no problem with sending another letter or notification saying that the fines will start in either 7 or 14 days. Everything that I could find on my own only called for either a 24-hour notice or a 7-day notice. So, but as far as, you know, I'm not sure the proper protocol if we just make suggestions to the zoning enforcement officer or, you know, to impose these additional fines. I don't really know. But
Actually, Dick, would you feel comfortable calling Lisa tomorrow and getting...
That's not a problem. The only, Kip is right, the notice you have to give, the longest notice for anything, with all the Board of Health building inspection bylaws, the longest required notice is 14 days. So if you send him a letter tomorrow, he has 14 calendar days to respond to any fine, and 14 days to me would be perfectly acceptable. It's gone this long.
Right.
But, and you don't have to, all you got to do is say, you're in violation, you're running a home business, contractor's yard, home business, et cetera, and you were to cease and desist and remove all such equipment within 14 days of receipt of the letter, and or you will face other penalties, correct term, and other penalty and fines as allowed by law. That's exactly how you write the last part of the statement. That's a no point one. So that would be my suggestion that the Board of Selectmen send it around and say that he will be fined within 14 days if he doesn't, or he comes in to make other arrangements.
But I don't think, I personally don't think other arrangements are acceptable at this point.
I don't either.
If he has not come forth in all of these months to respond to you, and he couldn't even show up here tonight, it's clear to me, you know, he has no intentions of doing this, and so we just need to do what we need to do. You know, we're not the bad people here.
So would you all be comfortable with Dick and Doug contacting Lisa tomorrow to get proper
language.
Letter?
Sure.
Yeah. Sure.
And
yeah.
And to make sure that the proper nuisance codes is...
Are you saying you contact her for the right wording of the letter?
Yes.
No, well...
To be sure we're on solid legal ground.
To make sure that the actual violation matches up. I mean, obviously, Dick, there are unregistered, more than unregistered vehicles there. That's
to the
easy.
Board of Health side, you simply go down to noise and nuisance trades.
Yes.
That's the catch-all. That noise and nuisance trade is running that truck, period. Running the excavator and the bulldozer. Mm-hmm. Okay? He has no permits to build or construct anything. So that alleviates, you've got a construction job going. And even if he did, there'd be time limits that you need to do this job in, finish it, or else, okay? Mr. Hunter's comment about dumping things, he's correct. Part of it's been dumped, bringing in excessive concrete pieces and stuff,
yep.
Which DEP has warned him about. I've written letters about. Fill is another issue,
mm-hmm.
Okay? Clean fill, without rebar, concrete, blacktop is acceptable. Okay. So that you can't stop.
There is a giant concrete
giant
step.
Have to be down that is, 6 inch, no more than 6 inch in diameter.
This thing is like 6 feet by 5 feet in his front lawn.
And what happens is the DEP said, according to the regulations, nothing can be dumped on the property over 6 inch in diameter, or that is a direct DEP violation, and that is what they want me to correct.
Yep.
So,
yeah.
You know, the alternative I have is to pick up the phone and call Larry Hansen from the DEP and say, Larry, I give up. And now the town has got a big problem. And that's where we don't want to go down that road.
Don't want to do that.
Right.
Plus, we've worked really hard to make sure we have a good relationship with DEP. Yes. So.
And I just think these people deserve some resolve.
Well, absolutely.
Yeah.
So do we make a motion to
have Dick write? I just want Lisa involved because
if
it goes to court, it's really important that Lisa be involved in the whole
I guess thing. I'm pushing the board to give an answer to say we'll write this letter and the consequences.
That's what the motion is going to be.
Yeah, we just want it
I just want to make sure
that's
that
all I want.
Letter of law.
I don't know people in the audience.
I can just offer this little piece of advice. Lisa Mead's not available until I think late in next week. However, we can contact Mark Bobrowski.
Yes,
in the same
Mark
office,
would
who would
fine.
Probably be a better person, given the nature of what
actually,
we're talking
Mark
about.
Actually, Mark would be fine.
I am happy to work with Dick tomorrow to craft a letter to get it before that office and to make sure we're on solid legal ground, and then we'll send it out registered and certified.
Yeah.
Well, I think if the chairman of the board should sign it. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's fine. I just want to make sure that in case this goes to court, that or I mean, we've had no cooperation, so. I would want Lisa involved, or whoever, Mark, one of them, to make sure that they are involved right from the beginning.
I just hope everybody here understands that there are specific ways you have to enforce the noise and nuisance trade scenarios with time limits. We're talking about different violations. We're talking about zoning violations, truck violations, noise and nuisance violations. And in the bylaws, nobody mentioned, there's a little more about the diminishing value of property.
Property, yes.
And that is part of the bylaw. And that, I had a real estate appraiser recently call because a piece of property across the street sold, okay? And they called specifically to find out what was going on across the street.
There are two cherry pickers that have been parked over there for 2 years.
He's under order to move those. Those are unregistered motor vehicles.
Okay. Cleaning up the property, does that mean those go, the dumpsters go? Those
dumpsters,
trucks that are parked out back?
In the letter, they told them to remove the commercial dumpsters. In the letters, it's told them to remove the sky lifts out of sight. Okay? They've been there for 2 years. Neither one of them runs. Okay, and now one of them supposedly belongs to the town of Leiden, and he's fixing it or something like that. Okay, so
that big box
I need clarification on what exactly we're trying
to do. Okay, all right.
Kip is going to make a motion. Excuse me, Kip is just going to make a motion.
I make a motion that we charge the building inspector to seek legal advice and write a letter to Matthew Gilmore to cease and desist all his commercial operations and to clean up the property and correct all of the violations within the next 14 days. Otherwise, he will be penalized whatever dollar amount the law allows.
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
A little amendment. Health code violations.
Yes. Absolutely.
Okay, to include all health code.
Health code.
Health code.
Violations.
Which would, but anything that goes there. I mean, that I see that, you know, the dumping constitutes one fine and fee. The unregistered vehicles constitutes yet another fine and fee. So, you know, you get whatever, you can lump it all together, or you can break it down, I mean, but put it all in one letter and just let him know that none of it's acceptable.
May I read that back to you, the motion?
Just a second. Dick wants to make a comment.
I just want to mention, because I don't know if Trevor's aware of this, but we spent town money with the backhoe digging up buried concrete because the DEP came there and started making dig it up by the road and remove large chunks of concrete. So the town has already spent money trying to clean up that piece of property.
Well, so, as far as I'm concerned, why we should send them a bill for that as well.
Exactly.
Excuse me. I like I said, we have spent staff time and town time and equipment time already. So is there any further discussion? Do you have that?
Can I read this back to you?
Yes.
Because I think I might have messed up the end of it. To require the building inspector to seek legal counsel, further to direct the building inspector to direct Matt Gilmore to correct all zoning and health code violations at the property on Mill Village Road within 14 days. And failing to do so, to impose such penalties as are allowed or required by law or town bylaw.
Sounds
okay.
Sounds like it
okay.
Covered it for me.
Dick, is that okay with you?
Yeah.
Got a question, Bruce?
He's not the owner of the property.
Nobody occupies the property.
The law specifically states in almost everything the property owned or controlled by you.
Okay.
So there will be a joint letter to both parties.
Thank you.
That's a good point, yes.
And we shouldn't be allowed to go ahead.
Pardon me?
Nothing.
Oh, okay.
Somebody second that, or?
Trevor
did.
Trevor seconded.
I seconded.
Okay. Is there any further discussion?
None.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I think we're all set then. Right? Doug, you're okay?
I believe so.
Dick, you're okay? All right.
I would just like to remind everyone there that what I said about the Chapter 90 violations through a police department, we don't control that. The police do. So if you do notice the vehicle running, call the police department, and they will go and issue the complaints or the citations.
It does work because we've had complaints about the rail yard, and people call us, Dick and myself, over the years, and we do log it. You know, would stand up in court, but calling the police is the official log, and that has a lot more weight in court, and it does work because we were able to curb the idling of the engines at the rail yard because people were willing to call in. When you first notice it, you call the police department. If it's during the business day, Debbie's there to answer the phone, and she will log it in for you. But if it's, you know, at night or on weekends, and the police, we don't have, you know, our clerk is not 24/7, even though our police department is 24/7, you'll get Shelburne control. And so you just give them the information, and that will get forwarded to our police department. So it is the official log, and that is what we would go to court with. Yes?
So could you just clarify for everyone, actions that should be called to the police department? Is that just a running motor vehicle, or are there other things,
just
including other noises or unsafe situations,
well,
that should be called immediately to the police department?
Specifically, I was speaking about the running of engines more than 5 minutes. That's what the police can act and find
that
right
is a,
away.
That is a Board of Health violation. That is what? Public health violation.
But if noise, if all of a sudden you hear clanging and banging in the middle of night, definitely you could call the police again, and that's something else. But, you know, the importance that I wanted to put on, you know, the running motors is that it's any running motors. It could be even if it's a snowblower. If it's more than the allowable time, you know, the police will go there and they will cite them. And, you know, if the police show up and it's off, I think they're still going to get the ticket. And the second time is going to be for $500. And this is going to add up pretty quick. So I think it's going to be a good deterrent. Bruce?
My last comment is you have made
appointments this evening to different boards and committees, and the person that owns the property has been appointed to certain committees and boards in town. I would respectfully submit that you withdraw this person's name from any board or committee.
I would, in with all respect to the gentleman's comments, I think that's a separate matter and has to be addressed separately.
I'll address it in public comment.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you all for coming. Hopefully we're on the way to have this rectified. You know what? We have our
EMS.
Yeah, EMS.
Yep.
We just better do this.
EMS.
Yeah.
Do you want to make a motion?
Oh, no. We can share this.
Do you want to take about 90 seconds?
Yeah.
Just wait.
Yeah. No, this is the appointment of the EMS. We didn't do the EMS appointment.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'm glad you had a good vacation. Dick, we'll jump down to you because I don't want you to hear her be here. Why don't you need to introduce yourself? And I'm just going down here. We had you. Where was it?
This would be. And I'm sorry, I've forgotten your name completely.
My name is Richard Evans.
And Richard Evans is here representing the doctor's orders. Massachusetts?
Yes and no. I'm not formally engaged by them yet, but I just came to have an informal conversation tonight. As you know, they have strong interest in coming to Deerfield to operate a cultivation processing facility and not a retail dispensary, and are seeking a letter of non-opposition or support from the board for that purpose. And this, of course, assumes that not only legal counsel, but all the other ducks are in order. We're just trying to get a general statement of support or non-opposition from the town at this point.
Dick, do you have a timeline on this?
Well, the
pardon me?
Is that Mike?
Oh, is that Mike on?
The mics are on.
Yeah.
Dick, do you have a timeline for your request?
Well, we are eager to see it as soon as possible. The client is eager to see it as soon as possible. They have a limit of, I think, about 5 or 6 months that they have to have it.
Okay. Well, we sent a request in today. Our legal counsel is on vacation. So, we can try to get an answer for you by our next meeting, which is July 12th. Okay?
Okay.
You could call Doug.
Sure.
And check in with him. I don't think, I mean, I personally have no issues whatsoever, but I'm just, I'm not sure since we have a host agreement with New England Patient Network now, what that does to have us have multiple growing operations.
I should hope it wouldn't interfere at all.
I don't think it's a direct competition, and I don't think, but we do need some legal input on this.
Sure.
We are always interested in new revenue enhancing operations, so I'm definitely interested.
Good. Okay? We'll see you on July 12th.
Great. Okay.
Thanks.
Sooner.
Good. Thank you
Richard.
Very much.
Thank you.
Do you have contact information or a business card? I just want to make sure I stay in touch with you. Thank you.
Doug is new, so he doesn't know who you are, Dick.
Emails. Sounds great. I like that myself.
Okay.
Thanks, Doug. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good
Bye-bye.
To meet you.
Sarah.
Hi.
Marlene. Marlene, you want to come up?
Yes. Hello.
I'm sorry to make you wait.
Don't worry about it. Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening. Okay. Marlene, why don't you just introduce yourself in case people don't know who you are.
Okay. I'm Marlene Johnson. I'm the South County Senior Center Director.
Nice to meet you.
Way.
Thank you for coming tonight.
Thank you for having me.
So you're going to give us an update.
Yes. Yes, I can. I can start with statistics because I just went through all our members and, you know, cleaning up that and see who is actually a participant and who are members. As of yesterday when I did this, we have 336 seniors who are active members of our senior center.
Is that in the town of Deerfield or is that for all three towns?
Mostly in the town of Deerfield, okay. But it does include Sunderland and Whately.
Okay.
Yes. And those are active participants. I mean, we have other seniors, probably up to 500 or 600 seniors that use our facility, but not on a regular basis. Okay. These are seniors that use it on a regular basis, whether it's one time, you know, once a week, twice a week, three times a week, or maybe two times a month. You know, they use our programs. In June, we had four new seniors join, three from South Deerfield and one from Sunderland. In May, we had three. Three of them were from Deerfield. April, we had seven. Four were from Deerfield, two from Sunderland, and one from Whately. And that one lives way in the hills of Whately. I have no idea even how I, you know, was able to get there to give her an application, and we got her some demand response. So now she's able to come on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays, you know, from the FRTA. January we had five, and February we had two. So about 21, 22 seniors, new seniors. I am starting to have the senior center open on Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Oh, wonderful. That's wonderful.
How I think we can do it without using any excess money from the town. My job is a 30-hour position, which I am required to be there Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays, 9 to 2. I mean, unless I let Doug know that I'm not going to be here and Sue. But on Tuesdays and Thursdays, I'm pretty much mostly there, whether doing outreach or, you know, paperwork or, you know, coming back later on during the day, that I thought maybe we could start off small with having movies once a week. We moved our cribbage tourney on Thursdays. We now have added yoga. Our yoga is going on. We even updated our newsletter. So we added a whole full calendar, a Monday through Friday calendar, to let our seniors know that, yes, you know, this day on Tuesday we're going to be open. Today we are going to have a movie. I'm also applying for a grant to have another exercise program start either Tuesday or Thursday. So that will help us open up the center more. And most immediate thing that is coming up is our annual barbecue. I guess the barbecue used to go at the Coves. I'm not from around here, so Barton Cove, mm-hmm. I think that's where it was. Mm-hmm. But this time around, I thought maybe we just have it right out here. So you're all welcome to come.
It's and when is that?
When July 13th, 9 to 3, 10 o'clock. We have coffee, 10:30 bingo, raffle, lunch, hamburgers, hot dogs. It's sponsored by Franklin County Triad and South County Senior Center. It's a pretty big event. Tents coming and stuff, so it should be a lot of fun. And we had a tag sale, our annual during South Deerfield Days. That was a real success for us. We did pretty well. I'm finding other ways that we can receive money. Grants are good, but they only run for a certain amount of time, and there's like a lot of documentation. There's other ways to do fundraisers. Sponsor something, have tag sales that we have been doing, raffles. Next week, actually July 23rd, we're having a craft and bake sale. We already have over 10 vendors who are participating at the center, who bought tables at the center.
Nice.
And we're going to open that up on a Saturday. So we're finding other ways to get finance instead of using, you know, grants and
I'm really appreciative of you opening up on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Mm. And so now that we're getting some warmer weather, how are you set as a cooling center? Are the air conditioning units working?
Yes, they're working. Yeah, we have one in the kitchen area, and we have one in it's a small area, so kind of open up the door and we'll close off one area, and then we're into the other meeting area.
So they are working okay?
Yeah, they're working fine, yes. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. And how's the outreach coordinator going?
We did, they did vote to hire someone, actually. Her name is Kate Gallagher. She has worked with Lisa, our nurse, here. We're just waiting for her to accept the position. So. Mm-hmm.
So you anticipate getting that started pretty soon?
Pretty soon, I'm hoping, yes. Okay. Yeah, because right now I'm doing the outreach. And
okay. So. In the past, mm-hmm. you know, if you feel, you know, just watching the weather, you're certainly able to contact Doug
mm-hmm.
and, you know, let him know that, you know, you're concerned about the, like, say, a 99-day or high humidity, mm-hmm. 95-day, whatever the temperature is.
Mm-hmm.
And then you can open the senior center as a cooling center and put it on our website, have Doug put it on our website.
Mm-hmm.
If you're concerned about anybody, you know, you can let police know. I'm hoping that we'll get the EMS to do, you know, some of our well-being checks. And if you're concerned about some of the seniors, mm-hmm. we can have someone go and check on them.
Sure.
I mean, we have a list of mm-hmm. People that we consider vulnerable. And so if you want to initiate that at any point, you know, you do have Doug's cell phone, so you can
yes.
do that. You certainly can call me.
Yep.
If, you know, I'm watching the weather, I, you know, start at 2, or, you know, any of the selectmen can do it. I mean, we feel very concerned for our seniors, so
mm-hmm.
that's what we've always done, is just if it's necessary, just start mm-hmm. it up.
Mm-hmm.
And if you feel, I mean, so far we haven't had such bad weather, but if it turns out that we're having lots of, you know, high heat, humidity days, don't worry about the, you know, what it costs to run the air conditioners. We, you know,
right.
certainly would cover it, because mm-hmm. it's very, very important to us to have a place where people can go and get cooled
sure.
down. So please do not hesitate or be concerned about that at all.
Mm-hmm.
Our priority is to have a safe space for people.
Mm-hmm.
And if you feel that someone can't get there, you know, just give a heads up and we'll try to get something going.
Sure.
We don't have anything formal, but, you know, there's a lot of people that will go out and do it,
mm-hmm.
drive, you know, even ourselves. We mm-hmm. have done that kind of thing in the past.
I'll keep that in mind.
Yeah.
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 So most general thing is just to keep outreach going, and, you know, and when the person starts, I know that they're on limited hours too, but just you know, kind of keep an eye out for who's vulnerable, and
mm-hmm.
you know, you kind of know.
Yeah, yeah.
I've
been
really
here for a few months
have,
now. Kind
yeah.
of,
but it's important to have a you know check and
mm-hmm.
and
sure.
This is not anything that you're not familiar with or that
right.
you haven't been doing, but it just we are very supportive of any kind of activity like that. So.
Great.
Please don't worry about your budget.
Okay.
You know, just, you know, we're right now we're in a drought, but we have, you know, we have a tendency to have high heat and a lot of rainfall. You know, that's the kind of thing that's happening with climate change. So, you know, having an active cooling center and an effective outreach method is really important
mm-hmm.
to deal with it. Did you all have any questions?
No,
well,
next. Thank you for your work.
Thank you very
Thanks.
Much.
You're welcome.
I really, really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And thank you for waiting.
Okay. Yes. Can I just throw one thing in?
Yes,
sure.
Please.
Just to let everyone know, the seniors, our seniors, you know, we care about them. We don't want to put on the back burner of finding another place for our seniors.
Oh, yeah.
For their center.
Certainly.
I mean, we do have enough seniors to participate, and you know, we can always do more programming and stuff, just to keep that in mind for
us. It's very much in
no pressure, just keep it in mind.
We're very hopeful that
Can I ask a follow-up question to that?
Sure.
Because I know it's come up several times on a variety of subjects. When it comes to the design or the consideration of a space that might be suitable for the senior center, I know that a lot of your programs start at 8:30 or 9 in the morning and run till about 2, 2:30, maybe 3, sometimes a little bit later. Mm-hmm. Would you have any opposition to a space being designated as a senior center, but then after, say, 3 o'clock, having it also be used for other purposes, public functions, perhaps the
organization? Yeah, that would be great, because that adds to our program. It would be... It just would be like something that they could look forward to. So no, I do not have a problem with that. I think our senior center, I think we could get a lot more younger seniors. I guess if that's the right word to use.
She's talking about us.
I know. 50, me. I don't know.
I said she's talking about us.
I really gotta be real careful about that, because I'm not really sure how to do that. But... I would really love to call our senior center a community center.
Yeah.
I think a community center would be so much more more receptive of people coming. So, yes, we have our programs in the afternoon, but then after we have a community event, or, you know, the library wants to bring over a speaker, or, you know, something else going on.
Some kids.
Would be beneficial, I think, for everyone. You know, to you. So I have no discrepancies about sharing that.
Okay.
Yes.
I know that has come up several times, is the idea of a public facility that's owned by the town and operated by the town, but something that could serve multiple functions for multiple organizations or multiple parts of the town's services to the public. So
I know.
Wanted to ask.
Yeah. We're hopeful that something will emerge.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Have a
very
nice
much.
Evening. Thank
Bye.
You.
Thank you.
Yes, you can come up now, Sarah and Julie.
We brought props with us.
Oh, great. Sarah and Julie, can you just introduce yourselves in case people are not sure who you are?
Thanks for having us. I'm Sarah Woodbury, the library director.
Hi, Sarah.
And this is Julie Cavaco, our wonderful children's librarian. So we did bring some things just to... this isn't really according to my speech, but they say you can't...
We're asking you for an update and some information, so this is fine,
you
Sarah.
Can't judge a book by its cover, but I think that's still true, but I just thought this was so beautiful that I had to bring it along. So I don't know if people can see it at home, but I'm just put it up there. These are
yes,
two of
we
the
have,
books.
We have brand new cameras.
Great.
So well, they're supposed to be really
color.
Good.
These are two of books that we were just added to the collection. We add books to the collection all the time. We also have recorded books. This happens to be the brand recorded books, but we have other labels. These go out for 3 weeks, and people are still listening to this kind of thing. We also have DVDs. We get new DVDs all the time, but they circulate right away. So when you come into the library, you might not see the latest, but you can put your name down and reserve it and get it from us or from another library. And we have we get magazines every week, and you, unlike some libraries where you can't take the magazines out, you can borrow a new magazine for a week. So I brought that. A lot of people like that. It's an expensive thing if you don't want to pay for your own subscription. You can come to the library. Time magazine. We have over 70 magazine subscriptions. We also have some music discs. People are still listening to these.
Great.
We also have ebooks that you can download free onto your device, and we can assist you in getting that done for the most part. Sometimes it takes a minute to figure out the device, but we are able to do that. So one of the most exciting things that's coming up in the future is we're planning for our 100th birthday. In November 1916, the library was dedicated, and we're planning a rededication ceremony to which we're going to be requesting the honor of your presence. And we hope you can attend. Senator Rosenberg has it on his calendar, as does Representative
Kulik. Do you have an actually date?
It's
November 5th at 1 o'clock, which is a Saturday. There'll be cake, and we hope to sing some of the songs that were sung back then.
Cool.
So we were just planning that. And we have a lot of activities for that year. And we're closing each, not every month, but we will have something almost every month for everyone. So we're really looking forward to that. I also wanted to say just about our collections. We have museum passes that people can borrow. A lot of people know this, but when people who don't know it find out, they're very excited. So I want to include this. It allows free or reduced admission to area museums. There's also one that allows parking at Massachusetts State Parks for free. So that helps you save a few dollars if you're bringing the family to Lake Wyola. Thanks, Julie. So I think I've covered everything. During the summer, our focus is on summer reading for children mostly. We do have two adult book discussion groups that meet once a month, the first Thursday and the third Thursday. One is discusses mysteries, the other discusses everything but mysteries. And Julie's going to be revisiting our Deerfield Reads program where we read the book Garbology, and she's going to teach people how to make baskets out of used potato chip bags. And we wish we had brought the two that Julie made. They're beautiful. And people come in the library and say, we want to know how to do that. And so Julie can figure anything out, and she's going to teach people how to do that. So,
cool.
And I just want to say one more thing is, starting July 9th, we're going to be increasing our Saturday hours from 10 to 1. They will be from 10 to 5. And so we've heard from many, many people that the Saturday afternoon is something that they were, hoping for. So we're going to try that for a year and see how that works.
Great.
So I think I've said everything I want to say. I wanted to give Julie a chance to talk about the summer reading program and her great Monday night music, which she's been doing for the past 11 years. So thank you. So, and that is something we do have. The Friends of the Library purchased a hanging system for artwork, and so it's quite easy to hang up artwork. And it's a little hot. Anyway, we have space where we can display art. Right now we have some beautiful pastels by a Deerfield resident. And you should come see them. They look great.
Great.
Sarah?
Yes.
Maybe Julie is going to address it, but I had some questions on the electronic e-books.
Yes.
Can you download and explain that you can do that at the library too?
Yes, we can. And if we can't figure it out, we can find somebody who can figure it out. A lot of times it's just learning how to use the machine the tool that you have. But yes, and we also have access help from CW Mars, which is the agency that we belong to that purchases most of the books, the e-books. And these are free. It isn't like you have to pay $9 to borrow it. You can borrow it with your library card. Anybody can get a library card, and library is open to everyone of all ages.
That's
so
pretty.
Julie, I'm going to let you sit here so you can speak.
All right, I decided to type it up so I wouldn't ramble. So our 2016 summer reading program, Stay in the Game, is up and running. It's in line with the collaborative summer programs that Massachusetts encourage libraries to take part in. Ours started with a family game night on June 16th, and it will end on with an event on August 30th. And it's supported in a large part by the Friends of Tilton Library. We decided to have a summer reading program start a little earlier and run later than the standard program year because this year's schools has an extended summer break. We feel that tracking reading by minutes encourages readers of all ages and styles to read at their own pace. It's proven that students of all ages do better if they read throughout the summer. And I'm glad to say we have adults, seniors, and all ages of students have signed up. I like seeing all ages interact throughout the summer at the library, so I plan events where all ages are welcome. Our most regular summer event is Monday Night Music that runs through August 8th. Usually it's on the lawn, but we have the option of moving it to town hall in case of rain for some of the nights. This year, we have a few new names on the calendar and a return of some favorites. There won't be one on July 4th. The benefit of having an open event like this is that it brings new people to the library and provides a weekly event for patrons to set up regular visits. This year, each week, we have a special daytime program for all ages, including adults. The days of the week varies because people often have different work schedules. The names are Tunes Days, Wanamake Wednesdays, Thirsty Thursdays. You may see I favor having a name with the event included in the day. The advantage of this type of programming is that it provides a free event and patrons can collect more books and keep on track with the reading. One thing I did want to add, we have a very efficient air conditioning in the basement. It's on a first floor level, and we have an area that's perfect for, there's a table, it's a good place. We have water and a bathroom available. So I've always thought of the children's room as a perfect cooling station. And I'm excited about, we're going to be open 5 afternoons now, and that's often when it's the hottest part of the day. So I encourage any senior when they're hot to come in on the first floor entrance and come in and cool down. I'm happy to give out water or freeze pops.
Julie, can you just reiterate the hours for people?
Yes, we are open Monday 1 to 8, Tuesday 1 to 5, Wednesday 10 to 5, Thursday 1 to 8, Friday 10 to 1, Saturday 10 to 1. Starting July 9th, we will be open on Saturday 10 to 5.
Wow. That's really good.
We continue to host our preschool story time throughout the summer on Wednesdays at 11. That can be a little clogged sometimes because you got all the babies running around, but we make it work. We started a baby time program on Fridays for our littlest patrons so parents can meet each other. That does vary a little sometimes because nap times throw people. So I would basically encourage everyone to visit the tiltonlibrary.org for more information if they are curious about more details. And then, of course, you can always stop and pick up one of our calendars with all of our events on it.
I've really loved coming to the Monday night music. It's been great. We've had 2 so far.
Been all of them.
What's that?
You've been to all of them so far.
Yeah, I have been to all of them. 2 this year. They've been great. And they're just so much fun. Caleb, when I got home tonight, said, I did my 30 minutes today. So,
right.
And he came, I think, to your function today, too.
Yep,
so
yep.
He's really taken advantage, and keeping him reading through the summer is great. So
today
thank
was,
you.
Thank you, thank you. Today was fun. We had Tunes Day, and we had Jay Stryker play the piano. And then I had kids walk around the room, sort of like musical chairs, and I called out a station that I predetermined, and the kid who ended up at the randomly the station of getting a little lollipop, and then we had cupcakes and ice cream because it was a cakewalk. So.
Yeah, it was good. They loved
it. That's so wonderful.
Yeah,
it's
a great,
really fun great.
It's a great, great place, great space.
Well, thank you both for coming, and I'm sorry to make you wait.
You're welcome.
It was really. I appreciate the update. I really appreciate the offer of the cooling station, Julie. That's wonderful. Mm. That's a good thing to get out in the community. And we'll try to put something on the website about that, too.
I tend to be frugal, so I keep it at 75, and people complain it's cold. So it's a really good thing. I don't mind going to work on hot days.
But it's good to get kids. We'll try to remind kids to go in the afternoon. That's
yeah.
a good activity.
Thank you.
That event at the library was the 5th?
5th of November.
Yep. Yes.
And
1 p.m.
The 100th is this year? 5th of November 2016?
Yep.
Fantastic.
We had no one from the rec department, right?
Actually, I did speak with Sue Antonellis. She's busy with an activity this evening. She is going to do her best to be here by about 8:15 at your meeting on the 12th.
Okay.
So it'll be another one of these sort of time-shifted
right.
things. But
mm-hmm.
I asked her about coming on the 27th, but she said she will be busy with field hockey that day. So the 12th is the best day for her.
on July.
Okay. We'll go down to public comments so that you guys don't have to hang around. But I just want to take a moment to say thank you to all those people who volunteered or donated to around town for the flowers. It's just so lovely to see. We don't have budget very much lately to do it very much, and pretty, and it's just really nice to see pretty, and I really appreciate it. We all appreciate it, but
absolutely.
I especially appreciate all the work and effort that people did to make it look really attractive. So thank you to everyone, and Doug, maybe on the website you could say thank you.
I will.
I would really appreciate that.
Mm-hmm.
Public comment. Yes.
Hi, Dylan Corpita, 165 Pine Nook Road, for a little bit longer. I wanted to bring up something that I've been thinking about lately. It's related to selectmen's salaries.
Yes.
And the question I had was, I was recently made aware and did not know that now with the new selectmen salary schedule slated to start in July 1st, the Board of Selectmen is eligible to earn creditable years towards a state retirement and pension. And I didn't know if that was something that you guys were aware of, had discussed. That was new information to me.
My understanding is that you're not, because you don't work 19 hours or more, over 19 hours per week.
I don't so think there were going to be.
Right, exactly.
You're not required to work.
I called the Franklin County Retirement Board and the state retirement board, and typically what happens is, first of all, there's a floor. Anybody who does not earn $5,000 per year is not eligible, which is why no one was eligible before, because the salaries were $2,000 and $3,000, I think, depending on chair or not chair, something like that. The new salaries,
$2,200.
Sure. The new salaries are $5,000, $5,000, and $6,000 for the chair, so all three positions would be eligible. The other thing is, typically, if you didn't work,
did you find out, is it eligible? Are they eligible?
Yeah, eligible for creditable
years towards retirement. Because I didn't think we met the hours.
Well, typically what would happen is, if you didn't work full-time, let's say you work 20 hours a week, they'd say, okay, then for the full year that you worked, you'd earn a half of a year towards it, because it's, you know, half of the hours. But not surprisingly, maybe there is a legislative exemption that any public elected official, so long as they meet the 5,000 threshold, will earn a full year for every year they serve on the select board, provided they earn 5,000 or more. Huh. And for me, this isn't really about the money of, you know, 5,000 or 4,000 or 6,000. That's a separate conversation we had at town meeting and settled. But it was new information to me, and I didn't know how I felt about a select position being a career, being something you could actually earn a pension for doing.
Well,
I wondered what you guys each thought about that.
What would you get?
Like $14 a month or something.
Well,
I'm sure.
I guess the point being that your pension is calculated off of highest consecutive earnings, so you could accrue a number of years towards the pension, being a select person earning $5,000 a year, and then work somewhere else for 3 or 5 years and end up with a very large pension, actually.
So we'd have to get a job in town government somewhere else, you mean, afterwards?
I'm just curious.
I think there are certainly chances of abuse, but I think it's important to realize that no one wants to do this job for no money, and it's a risk. If someone is going to make a career out of being a selectman, that's fine. But I have to tell you that you get worn out, and we're just not going to attract younger people if we don't pay a little bit more money. And, you know,
are you trying to just tell us about it, inform us about it, or?
Well, I'm curious if you were aware of it. That was my first.
No, I wasn't.
And I guess for me,
I'm not actually worried about it, because I just want someone a good person to replace me in a couple of years, maybe.
Sure. This isn't really about abuse. This is about the way we're setting up what these roles are, and not even specific to select person. Like, I don't think anybody should be in public service as a career at any level of government. Not everybody may share that view, but that is my view. And so when I see things like becoming eligible for pensions for public service at any level, That's something that I don't like. I don't like it that senators are there for 30 years and reps are there for 30 years and all the way down, federal and state. And I understand that there is a need to bring in people to want to run for selectmen. We did just have five people run for two positions. I don't know that this was the determining factor, and I just wonder if it's something that concerns you guys or how you feel, how you each feel about it, I guess.
Well, I guess my first thought, because I hadn't thought about it, is that it figures that our state government would create something like that.
Right.
And so I don't think that this town or this board has any control over that, no matter what we think or feel about it. It's something that the state has established, and you know they go by it. The raising of the salaries for the select board, I voted against it. You know, I didn't do this for the money. I don't know if people in the future would do it. I mean, I'm surprised at how many hours I really spend doing this job. And I'm not complaining, but it's really time consuming. And I would still be doing it even if I didn't get that whatever raise it was. But I think if you're asking if we're concerned of what we could do about it, if we cut the salaries of the selectmen down below that threshold so the selectmen wouldn't be available to it, it seems like the state rules are still there and that other people in other towns would be getting it. So I don't really know.
I just feel it is an incredibly amount of, if you're really going to do the job, Dylan, it's a lot of hours. And you just got to get, if you don't pay a little bit of money, people will not volunteer for this job because they can't afford to. You're only going to get old farts. You're not going to get younger people.
Hey.
I'm sorry. I know, but.
But I think there's room to.
We need this next generation. The problem is, if you look at our demographics, it's, you know, I mean, I volunteered in 1980 for the zoning board was my first position, I think, in 1980. And it just seemed like, Kathy, you were young people. There was people, young people. They're just are not young people. I'm thrilled to death that Trevor is willing to do this. He's a younger person.
You're a younger person now, Trevor.
But
how's that feel?
Sounds good.
The fact is, he's giving up family time and other opportunities to have money. And I feel that $5,000 or $6,000 is not enough money for this job if you're going to attract younger people. And, you know, and it does wear you out. Yes, Kathy.
I don't know if this is true or not, but when I served on school committee, we got $100 a year. And believe me, I went to budgets and negotiations. I served on the local board, and then I served on the frontier board. So, double that, there was this, you know, the certification at frontier hiring, all those. It's very similar, but so I guess my question would be when we get it, we always denied the $100 because we were told that if we accepted it, we'd be eligible for town health insurance, other town benefits. And we did not want to put the town in that position.
We eliminated that, Kathy.
Excuse me?
When I was elected, we eliminated that.
Oh, okay.
It was one of the first things we eliminated.
Saying, I know.
People still do not talk to me because that was a huge exposure.
$100 is what we got, and we denied it year after year after year. I don't know if the school committees take it.
Oh, it's $50, I think, right?
I have no clue.
Not worth it.
Sure,
yeah, I couldn't even tell you. It's probably $50 or $100, maybe.
I think
that's
$100.
Yeah,
but Kathy, and I certainly agree. No one takes this job for money. But what I'm saying is, it is a huge commitment of time, mm-hmm. and the reality has changed. Just like we have, the fire departments are having a hard time getting volunteers. The EMS had a hard time getting volunteers. You're not getting this next generation because they can't afford the commitment. And the idea of giving some compensation to the select board is so that you will get volunteers and that they will come forward that are younger and that won't feel penalized or that they can't take this job because of, you know, the the loss of opportunity. Certainly no one takes this job for the money. And,
oh, I know that. I'm just saying, time, you look at Kippy and Trevor and yourself, you're in a position where you can put in those extra hours during the day and everything else. You have that flexibility. And not to say it's easy, because I know it wasn't for me when I did all the stuff.
Not at all.
Just for school committee. And I can't imagine what it is for the selectmen and assessors and, you know, anyone else that serves as a volunteer basis. It's not just sitting here in front of the cameras. It's all the other work you do. But it's you know, we have a different population. And I don't think money is the issue for any of them. I think time is the issue. That's all.
Mm-hmm. Well, I feel it's important that we get, that we have to have some compensation so that it will be attractive for someone else to run.
Some sort of change so that we would be ineligible?
Well, provided that you earn $5,000 or more, I don't know that there's anything you can do to become ineligible. You can decline to apply for membership to the Franklin County Retirement Association or whatever they call themselves. I mean, you just ran was the $5,000 as an increase from the previous a factor in your decision to run?
No, I would have run anyways, but I will have to say it does help. I mean, I don't make a ton of money, but I'm lucky enough. I have a schedule. I fluctuate. I can get here a little early. I don't have to punch a clock. Mm-hmm. But it does affect the ability. If I'm here, you know, I'm not with my family right now. My brother's up. I can't see him tonight because I'm here.
Tell him I said hi.
And I will. And I haven't seen him for, you know, since my grandmother passed. But so it's been a long time. And, you know, my niece is here. I can't see her. So there's things you give up. And I don't mind any of that because I enjoy this job immensely. I don't want to say I don't care about the money. It does help a little bit to kind of offset, you know, the hours and hours that you put in, and I'm just getting started. I've not been on any boards yet and been knee deep in it, but it does, you know, it does take a ton of time, and it's nice to have a little thank you, and not that $5,000, I don't mean to say is, it's very much appreciated, but it doesn't make a difference whether I run or not. I would still do it. So it helps a little bit.
And just to be clear, if, let's say the threshold was $10,000, I wouldn't be here asking to reduce salaries. This isn't about making less money. This is about changing a position to one that is now a career. And I understand what you're saying about needing to have enough money to attract people to want to do it. But I guess I'd leave you with this. I think there's a lot of people who don't want to do this stuff because everywhere you turn, there is a legislative exemption, because everywhere you turn, there is a path to a career, because everywhere you turn, there is somebody who earns creditable years for 7 years, forms connections, and then monetizes that into a high-paying job for 3 years to get a big salary. And I'm not accusing select people of doing it, or certainly not you people of doing it, but this is the system that we're creating, and this is a big turnoff. Not just in this town, not just in this state, to politics in general.
Oh, yeah.
And so when I see it happening at the very local level, it makes me sad, to be honest. And so I don't want to take up any more of your time. I do appreciate your time and input. I guess I would just leave you with the thought to consider of, again, still a massive increase in salaries from last year, but something that leaves all three positions just under that threshold, and leave this position public services it was meant to be at the local level. And again, not because I'm afraid of one of the three people sitting here has some nefarious plan about taking this and running, but this is a one-way ratchet. It's never going to be undone if you begin it. So that's all I have to say.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dylan, I appreciate it. Believe it or not. Thank you. Yes, Bruce.
Bruce Hunter, 103 Sand Gully Road, South Deerfield. I would respectfully request the select board to not appoint residents of the community that have been found, or I'm not sure how to word this, but I want to make sure that
people that have been suggested to have not follow the bylaws of the community and have been officially sent a notified letter of their failure to comply with the bylaws of this town, that they not be appointed to any committee or board in this community. Specifically, I think relative to tonight's meeting, public hearing, there is potentially two individuals that might have been appointed, maybe one. I would suggest that you take that under advisement and make a determination. Thank you. The other issue I have is brought up at last week's meeting, and I was just wondering whether or not a bill has been, an invoice has been sent to Skims for the retirement payment.
You'd have to, Doug, do you know if Barbara has sent the bill? I don't know. You'd have to ask Barbara about that. Doug can find out for you if you're interested.
I will follow up on that tomorrow morning. Right. Is that directive of the board that we are to bill South County EMS for that outstanding retirement amount?
My understanding was that the payroll, they budgeted a certain payroll.
Sure.
And that the retirement was based on that payroll, even though that payroll wasn't not, in fact, the person was not hired.
Sure.
So we were overbilled. Technically, we were overbilled by the retirement system.
Actually, no, we weren't overbilled by the retirement system.
Okay.
Our bill would not have changed whatsoever. This was an internal transfer of money from the South County EMS, and I'm using terms very loosely.
Okay.
But
why
this
don't
was
you back up?
An
I was
internal
just going off the transfer.
Sure.
The reserve transfer.
So right.
Can you back up for everyone that's listening?
Okay. So let's take this from the beginning. We received a bill for an expected bill for the retirement costs. And that was X dollars. And our calculation was to take the expected payroll of all of the town departments, including South County EMS, and then allocate a portion of that payroll and basically assess a value or an invoice, if you will, an invoiced amount to each department that had an employee. So for a department that had one person, they paid one full-time person, they paid a certain small percentage of that retirement bill. And that broke down to a factor of 18.91%. That was how that is calculated. Basically, for every dollar, 18.91 cents, for every dollar paid to a person, 18.91 cents was paid to the retirement fund in that person's behalf. So when we got the expected payroll from South County EMS for fiscal 2016, we then, well, Zach put in, and then we assumed that the dollar amount that he expected to pay out was what he was going to pay out. And so we assumed a certain number, 18.91% of that dollar amount, that much money would be coming from South County EMS. And we put it in as a deduction to enable us to appropriate less from taxation. However, it was still being gathered, if you will, as a percentage of payroll as paid. Now, if he put down that he was going to be expending $680,000 for South County EMS staff, but only expended $440,000, and I'm making up numbers here, then that means that there was only 18.91% of $440,000 due from South County EMS.
So was it directly a South County liability? Or was it our liability?
No, it wasn't a South County liability. The town has to pay the bill no matter what because of the certain number of employees that we had. We were trying to assess or gather money back from South County EMS as a percentage of the payroll that was paid out in order to get some of that money back from the multi-town.
So that money that we moved, the $26,000, was not just for the South County EMS employees.
It was pretty much because of that expected revenue that we would be getting, that we would be recovering from South County EMS for the cost of their employees.
So the bottom line, without all the figures, is it still was an expense generated from EMS, the South County EMS.
Well, it was allocated. No, it was allocated.
It was
to them
allocated. If we want to be very, very strict, we did get exactly what we expected to get from South County EMS. What didn't happen is they spent 2/3 of the year not at a full staffing level. They were down full-time people who did not participate in the benefits program and therefore did not have 18.91% assessed to that, to based on the salaries that were paid.
So it's not really a bill to South County.
It's not a bill. It was supposed to be monies that we were expecting to be able to bill that we weren't able to bill because they didn't have the employees that they expected to have.
Were there departments that overpaid in?
Mm-hmm.
Like,
no.
Nobody hired
nobody
more
overpaid.
People.
No.
So it was just we were
so
expecting.
Let's back up. The bill?
Let's use the highway as an example. We hired a foreman around January or so, if memory serves. Mm-hmm. Now that person is working full-time, getting benefits, and there was 18.91% of his salary that was going into that retirement account. So, but again, that was actually 6 months of the highway department not being at full staff.
Right.
And we weren't, and we planned at that department not being at full staff. So and it doesn't really matter because that's money that's coming straight from the coffers of the town.
But the retirement does not bill us. It's based on actual payroll.
Correct.
So,
well, no, I'm sorry. Retirement is not based on payroll. They don't care what we pay our employees. They give us a dollar amount every year. They assess it. They take that into consideration. But it's not a, you paid this person $100, we get $18 as a result. It's not like that.
How do they know what to, like, just throw a dart at the wall?
It is a function of the number of employees, of the EQV of the town, and of their estimates as to what they need to be fully funded in their OPEB liability program.
Where did this bill come from?
The retirement.
It came from the retirement.
Yes.
And they didn't specify what it was for.
The employees of Deerfield.
The employees of Deerfield.
Just employees of Deerfield. So yes. We have no idea of what employees are Deerfield.
Well, we know that there's so many full-time employees in Deerfield.
Yeah.
They had to utilize the potential number of employees that Deerfield was going to have to establish that bill.
And they assumed.
And all departments either paid, if they didn't meet the number of employees, paid what they had proposed. And I believe that's correct. If a town, if
Doug,
a town
why don't you find out from Barbara if it is a South County bill, and if it is a South County bill that we are billing South County for it.
The reason for the request is the fact that Barbara has transferred money out of the South County EMS Enterprise Fund, but we've only transferred the amount of money that she feels she can properly transfer.
Right. So we are short.
So in other words, for example, if we're going by this formula of a percentage of everybody's salary, then you're taking 18.91% of all of the town employees' salaries, full-time employee salaries, except for South County EMS, where you want to take 23% of theirs. Because that's essentially what it'll add up to. Us asking for more money from that department than we can justify.
So I was trying to figure out, based on the reserve request that I reviewed, not what the Finance Committee approved.
Sure.
So I didn't hear what they approved. But so what you're saying is that we overbilled South County. Is that what happened?
We overestimated how much we were going to get from South County.
Okay, so it's
we overestimated how much we were going to get from South County because they did not have full staffing. We didn't get as much as we thought, and therefore we were caught short.
Doug, let me ask you.
Thus the transfer request.
If you don't mind answering. Now, you're a full-time employee. Do they take retirement funds from your paycheck?
Yes.
Every week?
Yes.
Or every pay cycle?
Yes.
Okay. Now, is that amount matched by some organization?
It is more than matched by the town.
Okay, it's matched by the town.
Correct.
Not by the retirement thing. So it's an amount taken out and an amount matched by the town.
Yes, and that, which goes to the retirement, Frank County Retirement.
Okay, and the people at the retirement account hold this money for the future. Now, does the amount that the town matches and the amount that you pay change?
Not in any given year.
So we should be able to figure out how much each employee pays. And it would seems like it would be a pretty simple way.
Let me clear
this up?
Go ahead.
May I attempt to clear this up? Each employee pays into the retirement board for their own retirement.
Correct.
The town is surcharged based on the number of employees. The town does not contribute any dollars towards an individual salary on a monthly basis. There's a yearly bill put together by the retirement board based on the projected number of employees the town has, plus their OPEB requirements, plus an equal valuation based on the town's annual payments. That number is established by the retirement board. They send out a bill once a year, and it's based on the past year's performance, is my understanding.
Okay.
I don't know, but Bruce, you're part of that, right?
I'm part of the retirement.
So, was it based on your salary or based on you number of years that you served, or
that
what?
Has nothing to do with it.
Oh, it had nothing to do with it?
I mean, what they take out is what they take out, and it's a percentage.
So what do you think would be the proper way of assessing any department? I mean, I know we don't have to worry about it only because of the ambulance, because it's a multi-town thing.
Based on their projected payroll and costs.
I think actually the way we...
40 hours a week.
We discussed with Barb and with Brenda, we discussed this concern, and I think the solution was to not base it on projected payroll or projected salaries, but to base it on past payroll and past salaries.
Do we get that choice?
It's all internal bookkeeping, yes. Oh. We very much have that choice. And it is all just a means of assessing a bill that we get, a single dollar amount bill that we get from the retirement board or for our workers' comp insurance or our unemployment insurance, and assessing that equitably across all of the full-time employees in all the various departments.
So what you could say is that the $26,000 should be assessed over all full-time current employees, all departments. So you can't blame one, is what you're saying.
Right.
No.
That'll be the fair way.
I mean, you gotta go one way or the other. I mean, you gotta pick and choose.
I would think that would be the fair way.
Let me see if I can explain this very simply what happens. What happened? And I'm going to use very round numbers.
I don't think the transfer.
I don't think discussion needs to continue. I'm fine. There's no bill being sent.
Well, I don't know if there's no bill.
Well, you can decide that, but I don't need.
All right.
We'll get back to you.
Okay.
Why don't you ask Doug? Doug will get back to you, and Doug will get to us, because I don't want to spend any more time.
I don't think we
should. Trevor, you need to get home to your family. No. I would.
I need to make this very clear.
Yeah, but Jeff, it's sounding like it was not described correctly in the reserve transfer. You can't bill South County for payroll that they didn't have. I mean, the shortage was because they didn't have full time people.
They didn't hire them.
So you can't. Right.
Where did that money come from?
Right.
We didn't have enough town employees. We got penalized because we didn't have enough town employees. Very.
Well, I think what we're going to do is have Barbara.
That should be spread out over all departments.
I think you have a few days in July to bill out. So
I'm getting that now. You're absolutely right.
Yes.
So he's absolutely right.
It's just an even.
If you expect to take a dollar from 100 people. To get $100 bill, but when it comes time to do it, you only have 90 people to take that dollar from. It's no longer a dollar; it's $1.10 or whatever the number is. Yep. He's exactly right. If we want to bill anything to South County EMS, it would be their portion, their ratio of the overall bill.
That ratio
applied to the 26.2. Right. Which would turn out to be something like
$1,500 or $1,500.
Well,
else.
And that's why...
You're exactly right. And I apologize for not getting that
okay.
You're right on.
And that was a good explanation, Bruce. So why don't, Doug, could we have Barbara on the July 12th agenda come and explain what she was going to actually bill South County, their percentage of it.
And where she's going to bill everybody else.
We're going to need to do that, I think, before July 12th.
No, but she can come here to our public meeting and explain what she did.
Fair enough.
So, because she could give us an update, just she'll let us know how her new hire has been hired and how that's going, and she can give us an update, and then she can explain to everyone on TV what the actual billing was to South County and what that transfer really was. Okay?
I knew I should have taken that course, political financing.
Okay.
It doesn't make a difference. We pay most of it. Yes. But the other two towns might pay some of it.
Some of it. But right? A portion.
This way she will bill the... I am the new fiscal agent, so I will want to make sure that everybody is adequately billed.
Yeah.
So.
Sounds good.
Okay. Doug, is that sorted out? And just, can you just put on your follow-up notes to make sure Kevin checks those trees, too? I know I asked you to do that, but can you just make sure that
If the trees are not, are the trees along the road line, the roadside?
Yes, they are.
Yeah, but I remember driving by having those roots exposed, and I was thinking to myself, that is a sure way to kill those trees. And if they are in fact dying, then we need to, those are pretty big. And they could be actually a safety issue. So
the first one, he did it. Closest to the road.
Those roots were exposed for quite a long time too.
There's a whole state, I don't know what you want to call it, rules and regulations about killing shade trees along roadways. I know, I learned the hard way.
Well,
yeah, there is a shade tree regulation. I just want you to be aware that when you go to cut a tree, you have to declare if the tree is endangered prior to cutting it or hold the tree here. So
we are aware.
You might, I mean, especially in this case, you wouldn't want to cut a tree down and have an emission.
Right.
Yeah.
We need our tree warden that we just...
Okay.
We need a tree warden.
Well, it just...
Funny, we have one now.
Yeah.
Well, at one point, I was... I was ordered by the state to remove trees for a driveway, so I did, and I had to pay for it, and yet another state agency came along and... you know, wanted to assess a fine because I removed the shade tree. And I said, well,
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
Government in action.
Yeah.
So
love it.
Do we want to point to
No. DOT won. Department of Transportation won the state argument. But.
I think the next item on the agenda is the South County EMS appointments. We want to make sure we get that done.
Do you have the full list?
Yes.
Each of you has the full list? Okay.
Yes.
I think you can just appoint the list as...
I found it.
I make a motion to appoint the South County EMS pay rates and June 2016 and FY17 appointment list.
I'll second the motion.
As presented.
As presented.
Is there any discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Make sure that there's no lapse in coverage... You have a full list.
I have the full list, and I'll make sure that this is recorded with the town clerk tomorrow.
No, because we don't have a 5. It's just supposed to be a 6. It's question mark 7. We'll check with Doug afterwards because there was.
That's different than what we had before.
Well, no, you know we questioned that. That there was no grade line.
Right.
Okay. Is there any reserve funds?
The reserve fund transfers you have in your packet, those do need to be approved by you. This is backwards, and I will take the hit on that. These should have been approved prior to going to the Finance Committee, but as the manner, as they, you know, just the way the timing worked out, the Finance Committee met first. So these are all reserve fund and appropriation transfers that have been approved by the Finance Committee, but they do need your approval. I don't think you have to do each one individually unless you feel the need to.
Well, no, I mean, I was looking at the South County EMS thing,
You're talking about the county retirement one?
Yes, the county retirement one. I just it is confusing. So you're going to have Barbara give us an explanation. You know,
I will.
And we'll make sure you follow.
Why that happened and what we've done to correct it.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. Did you all have any problems with any of these?
No.
Okay. No, I was here that night.
The only one I was trying to figure out was the
South County. Yeah, I was here for the Finance Committee meeting and listened to their debates and
okay.
We discussed this one about the animal control earlier meeting anyways.
Yes.
And
that was much earlier.
Actually a miscommunication.
Yep.
The budget actually was lowered. It was originally this amount.
Right.
You know, the whole amount.
Yep.
And then it was lowered, and it never got put back up to $15,704.
Yep.
It got voted as $14,510. Mm-hmm. So. Are we looking at the streetlights, Doug?
Did you actually just vote to approve those transfers?
Not yet.
Okay. I'm sorry. That's part one of the transfers.
Yes.
We are looking at that. I spoke with David Gilbert Keith and the Energy Commission Committee earlier today. What they're going to be doing is working with the Franklin Council of Governments to seek a grant for local technical assistance to look at the issue of streetlights. Broadly speaking, the lights are owned by Eversource. If we wanted to change them out to LEDs, for example, to reduce the electric costs related to it, we would actually have to buy the lights from Eversource to start with. They have absolutely no incentive to upgrade their hardware because we get billed and they're happy to bill us as much as they are. So in order to buy the lights, we'd have to get a price from Eversource, we would have to purchase them, and then we could go about essentially replacing the hardware with something else.
I know when we looked in this before, a few years ago, we were worried about maintenance.
True.
So when you are, can you weigh in some kind of factor for maintenance?
Sure.
Because, I mean, obviously, someone plows into a car accident or something, mm-hmm. we got to replace it. Mm-hmm. So,
well, most, my experience with the LED lights, they're pretty durable. And like you said, if somebody hits it, more than likely they're going to be insured, so they're going to pay to repair it.
Sure. But,
you know, whether a tree or something.
You have to have the ability to put the pole in.
Oh, we would not own the pole. We would just be dealing with the light on the pole.
Correct.
So we don't have to replace the pole?
No. It's just light fixture on.
We would literally be buying the light fixture.
If we have the light fixture, just the light fixture.
Correct.
Okay.
And there are retrofit kits for the types of lights that we have. That would simply replace it with an LED light instead.
Okay.
I suggested to the Energy Committee that they seek opportunities to do a pilot program where we selected, say, 8 or 9 lights in a central area in town and bought just those, transferred just those over to LED lights, and offered the public an opportunity to see what it was like, thereby building, hopefully, support for it and, therefore, support for the cost of doing the rest of the streetlights in town.
Would the Energy Committee be interested in seeking grants to do that?
That's why they're going to work with the COG, okay. is to see if there's any grant money available to fund a pilot program to do that.
I know Mass Save does a lot of incentives like that with businesses, so you would think that they might do it with the municipality.
Yep, and that's what we're hoping to find.
Okay.
So, Trevor, then if you're all set, or Kip, can you make a motion? To accept the transfers.
I make a motion to accept the transfers.
I'll second the motion.
Thank you.
This is a little backwards, but if there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
What are you doing now? You're doing the transfer or the streetlights? What are we
transfers.
Talking about?
Transfers.
They're all part of the same.
One of the transfer requests was for $4,200, I believe, in an overage in our streetlight.
They're supposed to come to the selectmen first. And then they go to the Finance Committee, but they're already signed. So it doesn't really matter. We don't have any real say. It's already been done.
I guess my question is, how many times do you transfer out this reserve fund?
How many times?
Yeah. Should this come before the town?
We usually spend about $40,000 of our 80 on a regular basis.
Okay. And that's through the fiscal year.
Through the fiscal year, yeah. And this is the end of the fiscal year.
Right.
I have felt since we were doing South County, you know, might want to increase the, reserve fund a little bit, but nobody wanted to. So we still use about half.
So is that transfer for South County still going to come out until it's?
Well, it's not really South County. I mean, that's.
It's already that amount has already been paid.
It's already been done.
So it's just a matter of now internally where we
we're just signing the paperwork
and fix it for next year.
Are those the only two? Didn't you?
Those are the only two that need signatures. All of the other forms, there's no place to sign.
Oh,
I will just make a note when I hand these over to Brenda that the board did approve them on such a date and time.
Thank you.
If I may. I think this is the right time. I'm sorry. I'll bring this up later on.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is the sewer commitment.
This is the second of the two billings for the sewer services provided in town. You should have a copy of both the sewer commitment letter as well as a printout of the information related to it. I have a copy of last year's if you care to see it.
Did you guys have any questions on this?
This is a kind of almost a pro forma thing.
Let me just read this real quick. So this is their budget?
This is half of their budget.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. What you're looking at is the budget.
Is the budget, and then this is their half. Is the number two of their.
Correct. That spreadsheet describes the consumption of water, and then the total usage billed out to town residents as a result. There's also a connection fee that's charged to every user. It's a fixed fee. And that shows the history of it.
So does this mean there's 884 bills sent? Is that
that's correct.
I'm understanding that?
Yep.
That's for sewer and water?
Sewer and water. I think there's more water customers than sewer. Correct. But the sewer bills are based on water usage.
Okay.
The assumption is what you bring into your tap, you'll eventually flush down. Right, exactly.
We have abatements that, you know.
Correct. In the summertime, the sewer bills are capped at 125% of the winter bill, with the expectation that you're watering your lawn or what have you.
What is the purpose? It's just to give us some history of what it has been?
Okay. Correct. That's it.
So in case you had questions, I mean, this is just, yep. This doesn't give you very much information.
No, it doesn't.
We discussed what the rate is going to be. Like, after the sewer meeting is going to, your sewer committee is going to meet, that will give us some information that we can base our decision to make what are the rates.
Okay. Did you have any luck getting hold of people?
Not yet. Sewer? I apologize for that.
No, I'm just curious. If we should be able to get something in a week or so, wouldn't you think?
Yeah. I hope so, yes.
Yeah. So I'd like to have, I mean, I guess it's not, you know, paramount, but it would be nice to have that when we get that committee together to see what suggestions he had.
Yep.
So, let's find that here. I make a motion to accept the sewer commitment letter and the utility billing 2016 commitment 2.
I'll second the motion.
Is there any further discussion?
No.
Nope.
Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Would you be so kind?
When we set the rate, when you all have recommendations and we go to talk about the rate,
yep,
for the winter rate, that's when we set.
Okay.
This is sort of just.
All right.
I think there's, I mean, if there was a disaster or something, we had to, you know, do some kind of capital thing, we could have increased the bill. But generally, this is just whatever it was in the winter, it's the same.
So get back to Doug.
Thank you.
Okay, next item on the agenda is, oh, the Lions Club request for tag sale moratorium for the July 16th and 17th. My understanding is they don't want the they don't feel that the moratorium is necessary, except for Elm Street.
Correct, not for the whole town, just for Elm Street and Elm Circle, and just for the day of the event.
Okay.
For that weekend, essentially. The expectation is that there's going to be so much traffic going in and out of those north entrances to the Yankee Candle parking lot, they don't want to encourage more traffic coming into the area.
Cars
so
stopping
that's
the
it.
Road and stuff.
And the board has done this in the past years.
Okay, I make a motion that we limit the tag sales on Elm Street, Elm Circle, on the day of the Lions Club.
July 16th.
July 16th. I was just looking for that date. July 16th.
I second the motion.
Is there any further discussion? Yep. Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Doug, you're up.
Okay. We have received a request, and I didn't make copies, I don't think, of this information, but we received a request from the Massachusetts Office on Disability to form a local commission, disability commission, and I've got some information in regard to what it would do. Broadly speaking, the commission would advise and assist officials in ensuring compliance with federal and state disability laws. It would help the town allocate monies from handicap parking fines for the benefit of persons with disabilities. It could provide research, information, advocacy, and technical assistance to the town, and coordinate the activities of other local groups organized to meet the needs of people with disabilities. CODs, or Commission on Disability, would consist of no less than 5 and no more than 9 members, and would work with the state office on disability. I have more information in regard to it, including a sample bylaw, some handouts asking, talking about what does a municipal commission do, as well as the state law, which authorizes it.
You know what, Doug? If either one of you have a problem, can you pass that on to Kevin,
sure,
who is our coordinator, and have him look at that and
okay,
have him give us some input.
Okay,
Kevin Scarborough.
Kevin Scarborough.
Yep. He's our ADA compliance coordinator.
Coordinator.
Yep.
So he can give us some input.
Yep.
I
thought this would also be a great opportunity if there's folks in the viewing audience who have an interest to express their interest. What's that?
I'll volunteer.
There's
okay.
one.
Put Bruce down.
One down, four okay. to go.
Yep. And
I will forward this information to Kevin,
yep,
to get some feedback and some advice on that.
Yep.
Sounds good. We already talked briefly
and
about the streetlights. I'm sorry.
Now, I just had a question on the fines, the handicap accessible fines. Is that statewide? We get to participate in a pool? Did you look
I
have that?
I apologize. I don't know for certain.
Is that only in
my,
our town
My guess
fines?
Would be fines that are only assessed locally that could then be
okay.
redirected towards specific purposes.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Sorry, Doug. I didn't mean
no,
to
No, that's fine. Let's see. We did talk about streetlights already and about the concept of buying streetlights from the utility and converting the LEDs in order to save money in the long run. That is something, again, that the Energy Committee is working on.
Okay.
There's a couple of other things that...
Is there a timeline on that, Doug?
On that, no. I don't have a timeline from the Energy Committee on that.
Okay.
Suffice it to say, it is something, trying to remember the phrase David used, something like letting loose the dogs or letting the cog out of the gate to start working on that.
Okay, because the only reason I was concerned is we want to make sure it's part of the budget process. If we're going to do any kind of purchasing or it's going to be something on the warrant, we need to take that in consideration. I don't know. I mean, this is probably a good place to bring it up. The state is so short. They're about a billion dollars short.
Yeah.
So what we need to do is, Doug, if it's okay with you guys, have Doug send a letter or email to both Stan Rosenberg and Steve Kulik and tell them, just reiterate that our budget was set based on estimated projections, that any cut to local aid, including Chapter 70, would have detrimental effects on our budget, and that we would really, really appreciate them fighting for our local aid. Cherry sheet, unrestricted money, Chapter 70 remains the same. If that's okay?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yep. Okay.
I've already got
make
a draft
sure that gets out tomorrow.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to actively call both Stan Rosenberg as well as Steve Kulik's office and make sure that I speak to somebody there and express the concerns of the town.
Tell them well just, it would be just disgusting.
It could be devastating, actually.
If we have to go back really, really and reopen hard. Our budget. And we've already had one special town meeting, and to have to go back again is...
Right.
And there's nothing to cut. I mean, we're bare bones already. So
they're from what I gathered from some of the, not really meetings, conversations at social events, it might get worse before it gets better.
Yeah.
I agree. But what happened is...
I kind of was making a joke before about, you know, political math. That's kind of what's been going on here. So.
Well, it's really devastating to have in January to have Mitt Romney... like didn't pay our school loan, you know, our school building fund. He just decided he wasn't going to pay that year. So we had to cover it, you know, for the school, the elementary school. I mean, he just decided that's how he was going to cut it. He didn't cut local aid, but he cut, you know,
the locals,
the school, you know, their commitment, 20-year commitment,
their
50% commitment to us, that's how they cut. So
did the town ever get that money back
the
year?
No, we had to cover it. We had to cover it. So we had to have a town meeting.
And you couldn't go back after the state, after the thing?
No, because it was their decision, and that's how they made the cuts. So it's really important that we stay on top of this. I think Charlie Baker is a little bit more sensitive, but I don't know.
That's another term.
He's... All right. So anyway, Doug, sorry to interrupt.
Not at all. I'm just making notes of that.
I just want to make sure we handled that.
You have something in the streetlight thing about C handout, but I didn't see it.
Do you not have that in the packet?
I don't. I may.
I apologize. I can provide some information in regard to it.
Just curious.
And we're digging through the archives because this was already done in the town back around, 2011, 2012. There were some streetlight shutoffs that were considered and some public hearings related to that.
Yep.
The idea of buying streetlights was considered at the time. And I think they ran into the same kind of brick walls that we are now, where the initial cost is going to be pretty high if we decide to do this. But given the fact that the long-term gain can provide us with maybe a third to half of our streetlight budget, or about $20,000 to $22,000 a year, it could be that the payback on that may not be as bad as we might think.
Right.
Do you have any clue as to what the purchase price per light is?
I do not. And actually, I asked that question of Ken Garber at Eversource, and he said, well, I can't give you a price or an estimated price. I would have to know what street lights we're talking about, where they are, and then I would have to consult with X and Y and A and B, and we'd have to give you a price list. Essentially, it was the run around the block.
Yeah. In most areas of town, the telephone poles themselves belong to the telephone company.
Verizon.
There are very few poles in town that the electric company goes on. I don't know what the rules and regulations are, who have rights, but my understanding is if there is a pole there that the utilities themselves, no matter what they are, have the right to use them, whether it's for cable, telephone,
so
electricity.
So even our light poles that have no telephone.
Right. So where I was going with this is that if the price of buying the lights from Eversource was so great, or if we could look into just buying our own lights and putting them there, and then, you know, it might be a lot less. Because, you know, for a few $100, you could buy a very good light. You know, I'm sure it would cost, you know, $100 to get it installed, but you know, if they want $1,000 or $1,500 for each street light, you know.
My guess is that they're going to want $1,000 or $1,500 for each street light. But unless we're putting our own poles on town property, we're going to have to rent space on a pole. I know that the cable company actually rents pole space from Verizon, for example. The TV cable company does.
I wonder if it's cheaper.
And they pay on a regular basis. Yeah.
Well, so obviously, the Energy Committee is going to look into it, but
absolutely.
Okay.
Make sure that they're looking into all those kind of questions.
Absolutely. And no matter what, we're going to take it in small steps.
Yeah.
And move forward very slowly.
I just want to make sure that they're part of the budget process.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Absolutely. Okay. There are two additional things I would like to bring before the board before I request an executive session. Hopefully, they're very easy things to do. They are both contracts. But they are contracts for things that we already do or that we can do. Both of them come from the Highway Department.
Yep.
The first one is very, very easy. We normally make use of services from the town of Montague for their vacuum truck, their Vactor truck, for cleaning out culverts and drainage basins and things like that. Most recently, when we needed to get their services, the town of Montague gave Kevin essentially a one-page MOU, which just solidifies the prices that we pay and the terms of the use of the vac truck. What he's asking is for your signatures on this, and I can give this to you. I don't think you've got a copy.
I do.
Do you? Okay, so it's in your packet. It's, according to Kevin, these are prices that we pay normally for the use of the equipment.
Yep.
The terms are very reasonable,
yep.
And it makes sense to move forward with it. So we ask that you approve that and sign the contract.
Okay. I make a motion that we approve this. It's really a memorandum of understanding.
Mm-hmm. It really is. It's an MOU.
Yeah.
It only depends on, you know, we only pay when we use it and so.
Yeah. With Montague for the VAC truck.
Second.
Is there any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
No, it is a rental agreement that if we want to use their truck, they'll let us use it for $125 per hour.
I heard this. I just didn't know if it was for past.
No,
they did come recently.
Right.
Yeah.
We've been using it actually for more than just recently. Yeah.
And what Montague is doing is just making sure that everybody's covered.
Yeah.
By putting this together.
Yep.
No, it's great. Certainly.
$400,000
truck.
Right.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yeah. My understanding is, just for the public's information, that truck never stops. That Montague uses it, and when they're not using it, it's being lent out to other towns for use. That truck is going 40 hours a week. That it's a very valuable piece of equipment. I asked Kevin if he would be able to make use of something like that in town. He said, absolutely. And he feels that we're not doing enough to keep our basins clean and keep them free
again,
from grit and
$125 an hour divided by 400,000 or however you could.
Oh, yeah. No, it would be a tough payout, but that's why we're
renting. My understanding is the Mass Works, that is part of the Mass Works.
He's going to try for that.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
It might get kicked out, but so whatever.
Give it a shot.
The other thing that I have, it is a big, hairy contract with lots of places for you to sign, but this is a good thing. As I mentioned to you a few weeks back, the town received a grant from the state as part of the Community Compact Program. This is a grant for an improvement of our IT services, specifically relating to data backup off-site. The grant is in the amount of $45,000, and all we need to do is actually spend it, and there's no payout.
Is there any security aspect to that? I mean, the backup is security, but I meant other security features of that grant. Can you just...
In terms of security for town data?
Yeah, I guess I was looking like firewall stuff or whatever. I'm technology challenged.
Well, what we're doing is...
I do know that we need to do more here in town. And
absolutely. The grants that was written was specifically for off-site backup. With the expectation that we're going to create a private network, a direct connection between this building, the town hall, and another building close. It could be the school, it could be the senior center, it could be the library. Whatever we determine is going to be the best option. I'm hoping that will be a direct fiber connection that will lay fiber underground to whatever building we're going to go to. So it'll be very, very high speed. And then at that building, we will place a data storage device, a box that sits in a closet someplace, so that on a regular basis, our data from all of our computers, from all of the equipment here, goes down the pipe and gets backed up on a regular basis. This is not being done now.
We're not restricted to any one particular company or...
Not at all. Okay. There are a number of companies I'm going to be talking to when it comes to putting this together, and I'm hoping to actually not split the bid per se, but to break apart the project into several components, where one component will be the creation of the fiber optic network.
Yeah.
Another component will be the purchase of the equipment.
Do you feel confident that you understand this whole process, you know, the equipment?
Because
I have some friends in the computer business, and they tell me these horror stories about, you know, prices go from here to here for the same thing, you know.
Oh.
And,
yeah.
You know, someone like myself with a computer, I mean, I...
Right. And I'm not going I'm not going to restrict myself to the idea of a hard wire. Yeah. There's the possibility of a two-way wireless link, which would still be secure but slower, but it may be more cost-effective. So the... But part of this will be to harden our firewall, if you will, to basically provide less access from the outside world to the computers and, more importantly, to our storage
devices. I'm just really concerned about the, you know, all the hostage stuff.
Absolutely.
That's happening. I mean,
Someone can hack in. Plant a virus that can encrypt your data, and oh, now you need to pay $20,000.
I mean, it's happened in Long Meadow and Pittsfield, and to small organizations, not, you know, big organizations. So
any IT security person will tell you that the best defense is to tell your staff to never open an email from anybody unless they absolutely know who it is.
Yes.
To always have antivirus on their computers. To always have, to always have confirm attachments. If you get an attachment from someone in an email and you weren't expecting it, don't open it, don't click on it, don't read it. And the only way to completely secure your network is to close it off from the public, to have no inbound connections from the world, which that would cripple us. Actually,
well, couldn't you have? It might sound expensive, but couldn't you have separate computers? You know, like one that you go to the outside world, and yet another one.
Sure.
That
yeah.
they're not talking to each other way.
That is possible.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, we're looking at doing not quite that, but in the clerk's office, she is looking to actually set up a second computer at her desk that would be exclusively for the banking that she does, and that it would have no other purpose, no other use, and no one else would be allowed to access it, which would make that a much more secure operation.
So I'm going to make a motion to sign the off-site storage data.
It's a community compact IT grant to accept the terms of the grant, and
I authorize the chair, Carolyn Ness, to sign.
That makes sense.
Like there's only one spot.
Is there a timeline on this
grant?
You have to spend it within the fiscal 17 year.
Yes,
I think.
We have to spend it by I think June of 17.
Can I make a suggestion since we don't know where South County is going? If you're going to have to add on somebody. If it does go in Deerfield, there's a lot of HIPAA information that might be the place to add on. You said you could put it in the school, senior center, library, wherever. And since we don't know where South County is going, that site, if it may end up in Deerfield, might be a consideration.
The HIPAA information stays on their computers. It doesn't go anywhere, Kathy.
Oh, I understand that, but Doug just explained that we could add somebody, and it's in, you know, to the system, and I don't know if that's...
Well, I think what he was referring to, and I could be wrong, was just another location to keep it in, not necessarily, you know, to add it into it.
Oh, okay.
What I am hoping to do, though, is possibly to leverage... And it's why I'm very interested in talking with the folks at the elementary school, is I'm hoping to leverage the more expensive part, the fiber optic link. If we create the fiber optic link between here and the elementary school, which has lots of computers, lots of data, then they could make use of that same link to do offsite backup of their data here at Town Hall.
Right.
Which gives them the added protection. Now we're really leveraging the expense
right.
For both organizations and doubling our benefit. So.
Bruce?
Does this grant cover all the expenses, equipment, and installation?
Yep. The expectation is
there's
that...
No expenses beyond this?
That's correct. That's correct. Right.
So even for the underground trenching and everything else?
Everything has to be covered by the $45,000. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Which is why I'm looking at also other options, either a high-speed two-way Wi-Fi link or a high-speed microwave link that has options. Those may be more practicable and less expensive than a fiber. I know a microwave link would provide very, very good speed, but a fiber optic link is going to be the fastest.
Did you second Kip, or somebody second it?
I did.
Okay.
If there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
And I believe that, let me see, the only other thing I have is to request a very brief executive session for two purposes. One is for the purpose of discussing sale, purchase, or transfer of real estate. The other is for to discuss strategy in relation to non-union negotiation with personnel. Negotiation with non-union.
Did you want to just go over meeting dates?
Oh, yes, I did. And that was what I was going to.
Although we might want to do that in executive session, because you don't want to.
No, the public meeting dates you mean for next year?
Well, or we were going to talk about if people are on vacation or something. I mean, that shouldn't really be public.
Might be a really good idea to do that off camera. Yes, yeah. Because you don't want to advertise when you're going to be when your house is going to be empty.
Right.
Yeah.
So, why don't you propose the dates? Do you have the dates?
I do, and let me just pull those up. What I was going to do, simply put, was to I wanted to get permission from the board to post your expected meeting dates for the next fiscal year, and have that available on the public board outside. Post that in advance. This would be a listing of all the dates where there were where there will be warrants to sign. It's assuming that the dates will be on the Wednesdays. Starting at 6:30, and it will list the skeletal agenda that we use as a pattern for all of
the
our
only,
meetings.
I don't have a calendar in front of me, but I was interested in are we meeting the Wednesday before Thanksgiving and the Wednesday before Christmas?
It actually works out to be the Wednesday after Thanksgiving and the Wednesday after Christmas.
Oh, okay, then that's fine.
Three or four days after each.
I'm sorry to be a fart, but I do the cooking.
No,
perfect.
No, totally. The only other thing I have is
so
I just want
Thanksgiving.
Cross-reference.
Okay, so the 30th and then...
School committee?
I don't know how it worked out.
Oh, and with the school committee.
Oh, I see.
Because those are Wednesdays, but if we can just, like we do, adjust it to a Tuesday here and there.
Christmas
but I can get
is
you
on
those
Sunday,
dates.
So
we're going
to
meet on the 20th.
I'm happy to work this out and work out any differences before it gets posted. But what I wanted to do is just make sure that the public is well aware of the days where they know that there's going to be meetings and to reassure the public that a public comment section is on every agenda.
Doug, maybe you could just look at the Trevor's Tuesdays.
Sure.
It's just once a month. It's only once a month.
Wednesdays?
It's Wednesdays.
But it doesn't always line up. So.
Right, exactly.
So it might only be a couple that we have to change.
Well, Trevor, you could get a little monitor and just watch it and comment.
Right, exactly.
So the two Wednesdays at the end of November, the one is November 30th, and then it's Wednesday, December 28th. Those are the warm days.
Those are fine.
I'm
okay with that.
Out.
I just didn't want to... I've taken over the holidays, cooking for the holidays for my family.
Great.
And
we're all invited.
Yeah. Well, my mom... I've done this for the last few years, and I have a house full of people, and then I have to cook, and I can't be going to Selectmen's meeting before Thanksgiving.
Oh, here we go.
This doesn't work.
If you want to just run through those dates, I'll check.
Yeah, so I've got, let me just see here. So we're starting in September, September 14th.
That's good.
October is Thursday the 6th, the joint meeting.
Okay.
November, it is the 2nd.
That's a conflict with an expected meeting date.
So we move it to the Tuesday.
The 1st.
So it would be November 1st.
Tuesday, November 1, instead of Wednesday, November 2.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's not an election day, is it?
Oh, it might be.
Is it the first Tuesday in November?
Yeah.
Oh, actually, it might be because...
Is it a presidential election?
Can you put it to November 3rd?
Sure.
Thursday?
Yeah.
Yes, we can do the 3rd.
Maybe still counting votes.
No, it's not that.
It's not going to be that close.
Not in Deerfield, at least.
You know what? Why don't you check with Barbara to make sure that is... Usually it doesn't... It is the first Tuesday, but...
What, the 7th of December?
No, it's the first Tuesday.
Yeah, that seems like having November 1st, though. Is...
I know.
November 8th. Election day in the United States will be November 8th, 2016.
Oh, okay, so then we'll do it. We can do November 1st. Yeah, usually it's the 7th or 8th because Madeline was born on election day.
So we'll do Tuesday,
it's
November
7th,
1st.
When she was born.
And then I've got December 7th.
That is not a conflict.
Great. January 4th.
Also not a conflict.
February 1st.
Not a conflict.
March 1st.
Not a conflict.
Joint meeting on Thursday the 6th in April.
This guy knows what he's going to be doing a year in advance. That's pretty good.
Next May, it'll be the 3rd.
Wait, what about April?
April, it's Thursday the 6th. It's a joint meeting, so it won't. That'll be good.
May 3rd is a conflict.
Okay.
You want to make that Tuesday, May 2nd?
Sure.
If you that's can. An election. Is that the day after elections?
Oh. Right. Do we?
Deerfield.
Yeah, well, are you going to run again?
I got to know already.
We're changing the meeting for you, Trevor.
Yes, please,
right.
Can you?
All right, then let's change the meeting.
I'm declaring my candidacy now.
We have competition because
that's right.
A discussion on it.
That's right. You never
Tuesday,
know.
May 2nd.
I'm not letting him off the hook. We got a live one here. This less is 60 years old. We're getting them.
And then Deerfield, let's see, June 7th.
Not a problem.
Great.
Okay.
So it's really just two.
Were there any other conflicts that you can think of? Okay.
I was just concerned about Thanksgiving and Christmas from a purely
like we're avoiding those.
Selfish point of view.
Yep.
There was, that's my only request.
And this
every
will go
year.
Up on that new website calendar you're talking about?
It's going to have a selectmen's meeting before Thanksgiving.
Oh, great. Perfect. Just so I can get a copy and I'll plug it in my phone.
I'm going to print this out right now so you have a copy of it.
Great.
Okay.
But before you vote on it.
Have to vote on our meetings a year in advance?
Well, we're changing. I mean, we're setting the schedule. He's going to post it.
So are your next two meetings going to be the 13th or 27th? You've done the whole year, but you haven't done any meetings.
Actually, this keeps getting printed wrong. That's why we're doing it. We are not having a meeting on the 13th. We're having it on the 12th. Because we have a meeting here on the 13th in a small town, rural...
So this Thursday night, we're at the Greenfield Country Club.
No, Wednesday is at the Greenfield Country Club. Thursday is
tomorrow.
Tomorrow's
at the
Country
Club. Tomorrow.
So this is just a copy of what I was going to post.
And you posted us at actually Trevor probably isn't going to be there, but the MAPCO meeting tomorrow night.
Yep.
And
I'll be there
Thursday at the Selectmen's Association meeting at Mohawk Park.
Well, I wanted to go, but there's also municipal. We signed up for a municipal. Are you going to the municipal law thing, or what did you decide to do? Or are you doing either of them?
I haven't either.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay. Well, we can talk about it later.
All right, we'll talk later.
It's okay.
Your calendar's working better than mine.
Meeting with all the boards before the budget process and your superintendents or whatever you want to call them, all the heads of your departments.
Mm-hmm.
So is that additional meetings to all this, or are you going to try to fit them in on your meeting dates?
We're going to try to fit them in on our meeting dates.
Okay.
Only because, I mean, or we might end up on an off meeting. I don't know. It depends on, I mean, hopefully things will settle down a little bit.
In which way?
I mean, our agendas, if you know, hopefully our agendas will solve. You know, we'll not have too much on the agenda for in the next couple of meetings, and we can pick a date and get everyone together.
Are you going to stagger them or have them all at once?
Well, I would like to see us have a joint meeting so we can talk about stuff, but we haven't really talked about it. Because we've attempted this once before. We had a big mass meeting, and it was not as productive as we thought. And then we tried to break it down with just different, you know, have one or two committees come every meeting. And that wasn't too productive either. So I don't know. I mean, that didn't seem to work out.
We don't have productive people, apparently.
No. We were trying to find different
fit too
ways
much
to,
in.
To try to figure out how, you know, so, but if you met committee by committee, then people felt disconnected and they didn't know what was going on in the big picture. We were trying to present a big picture, and
well, maybe
and
we
that
could
never happened. We just got individual pieces.
So I know going into this next fiscal year, are you going to, as a select board, give them directives to where you want them to be?
Well, actually, what we wanted to do was to review what they thought they were supposed to be doing, because there was some huge misconceptions in a couple of committees.
So you'll do that amongst yourselves.
Yeah.
And then give them that.
And so we need to sort out what we haven't had a chance to sort
right.
out. It hasn't been a time for us to sort out exactly where we are as a committee, because, I mean, usually you don't have two new people. So this is really a new era. And so the idea is to talk about what Kip and Trevor's perception is, and then how to mesh it with what people think they are supposed to be doing and what we would like them to do. I think we've had some discussion already with the Energy Committee, because there are a lot of issues that we would like to be addressed. We set up the Sewer Committee because we need some information, and we feel people will really look into it and give us some direction. Those are really the only two committees that we've sort of off and running right away. The Historic Commission has a couple different ideas what they would like to do, and you know, I was really happy about it, but Trevor and Kip don't know anything about it at this point, so. I think we have to decide if we're going to go, and it might be productive to go committee by committee at this point, because you know, both of them are new. But
at some point during your discussions, I really would like to see, as a town resident, that everything get on the warrant that needs to be on the warrant, and if it doesn't, then you wait. And because I've been, you know, an advocate of not having all these special town meetings because it wasn't worded right. We didn't have the numbers. I mean, that's...
I know.
Because in the past, it's just been too many, whereas before there wasn't. I just would like to see it done in a two-night meeting schedule, whatever it takes, Saturday, however, but all done down the... Everything covered at a town meeting.
If I may speak to that, my goal, my personal goal for this coming year is to have a draft warrant on your desk by the end of December for the annual town meeting, so it may be ready to go by the end of January. That being said, I do also anticipate a request for a special town meeting in the fall to do a number of non-financial things which may be coming forward, bylaw changes and so on and so forth. If we are going to move the town meeting, the annual town meeting, you will need to change the bylaws to do that. It must be on the fourth Monday. It must start on the fourth Monday of April, according to the bylaws.
I know. Well, we've talked about how to get more participation, Kathy. Mm-hmm. And we sent out surveys, and pretty much people were happy to have it on the Monday. You know, nobody wanted it on the...
the day.
Yeah, nobody wanted it on Saturday.
I just know Doug suggested at a meeting. Yeah. I think at the last time that we did a survey,
nobody wanted it on a Saturday. And I understand that.
I just have an issue with too many special town meetings and things not making it on the warrant and the warrant not being printed properly. So it has to go to another town meeting, and you know, we pay attorney fees. We know what's going in. We don't have the money for next year. People just have to cut back. And you know, I just know personally from my taxes that my assessment on my house has stayed the same, but my taxes have doubled. And I just, you know, that's a big deterrent for me. Looking at the town of Deerfield, everybody used to say the taxes are low, you get good, you know, the services are good, the schools are good, everything else. And now it's like, you see a lot of for sale signs around town for whatever reason. You know, I don't know, but I don't think the town of Deerfield is where a lot of people are looking to come because of, you know, the taxes are getting online and everything else.
Actually, if you have a comparison, we're doing pretty good. I know you don't agree, and I don't, certainly my tax bill has doubled too, but I just, and my assessment has stayed the same, relatively the same. But I have to say that compared to other towns, this is still a very desirable place to live. And the for sale signs are not as numerous here as they are in other parts of, you know, the county. So, I don't know, we can debate that all night.
Right.
But it is still a very desirable place, and people still really want to come in.
It's just sad to see you.
One consideration, hopefully, or I'd like to make a suggestion for consideration, I guess it'd be, before the budget season starts, to have a meeting between, as minimum, the Board of Assessors, the Select Board, and the Finance Committee, before the Select Board starts meeting with other departments, so at least those three financial committees can all get on the same page as far as revenues and expenses, so we all know where we're going, and we have a common cause. If nothing else, that would be very helpful. I think it'd be very helpful, at least to the Finance Committee.
Absolutely, Jeff. And I think we have to wait to what happens with the state. I mean, they're having a budget through the end of July to keep the state going. But once they get some information to us as how they're going to manage their budget, I mean, one of the problems that we were so short and why we had such a crisis was, you know, after the crash, the 2008 crash, you know, the federal government kept the money coming to the states through the HARP all that stuff. So, but then that money ran out and then the state started squeezing us. So we actually had a delay where it was budget year 2010 and 11, it would have been fiscal 2011, what was the terrible year for us. And that, you know, 11 and 12 were the really tough years. And so we just have to keep an eye on the state. And we should have some kind of information, I would hope, by, you know, end of July, beginning of August. And we will try to put together a meeting, you know, once September comes around, because we'll know what the situation is with the school roof, what the actual final cost would be. I mean, Kip will be keeping us informed, but we'll have a final amount, so we'll know what that end out would be, and we'll have an impact on what we can be looking forward to, you know, like capital improvements. You know, we'll have some indication of where we're supposed to be going, so I would love us to meet probably after Labor Day and really try to sort this whole thing out. Because I think we'll have a final, we'll have a kind of indication what our expenses would be, and then maybe some indication what the revenue, if there's any fallout from the state budget and stuff like that.
Well, I think it would just give us a better picture of where we need to have.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Give us an insight.
Yeah.
That's why I say at least a minimum of those.
Well, and we'll have our we should have an indication of what our certified cash is and stuff like that. So that you know, that's really key too. So
and I think that would prove very, you know, beneficial for us, you know, setting up for the budget season. But you know, one thing that I saw last year a lot is that there were times where the finance committee spent a lot of time debating different things, and at town meeting it was overridden anyways. So I mean, it's something that's difficult to predict how the people are going to vote for things. You know, that's they're right.
But once you bring that forward, when the people vote, so the people vote,
right,
and you live with it,
right.
But I guess I'll say it publicly, I don't care, but I guess what I found a little difficult, and it was my first year on the finance committee, is to have people come in with requests and sit there, and they are your department heads and that, and so you're trying to be the check and balance, and well, is this budget's being a little overspent, you know, what percentage are they coming in at, what are we trying to accomplish for a percentage as far as across the board, are we trying to hold a percentage for all the departments? So, and without having any true anchor as far as a true point, it made it very difficult on the finance committee to be able to try to address, and we did try to address all departments as fair as we could. But when you bring it to the public, you're bringing it to, well, here's your request dollar amount, and these are what the finance committee recommended. And if they're less than what was requested, all of a sudden it puts your finance committee in a negative light. And my thought process is maybe approach it a little differently to try to keep this as positive as we can. You try to project a percentage within your group, within your committees that are dealing with the finances of the town, and look at it, whether it be a 1% or whatever, and say to the departments, this is what we're projecting we can afford. We can afford 1%, 2%, whatever the case may be. Now you, as department heads, go back and live within the means of the town. And then when you come to, you bring it forward to the voters, at least it doesn't look like your finance committee was the butcher people.
You know what, Jeff? I'm really sorry that you felt that way. We tried, you know. Obviously,
no, I'm just saying.
I'm just saying. My discussion always with the department heads is you're allowed. We only can go up by 2.5%. So the goal is to get 2% or less increase,
right.
And then within that, you know, the municipal budget, there are going to be things that go way up because
right.
You have no control, like X number of people from
right,
school
yeah,
signing
right.
up for health
right.
insurance. We, you know, there's nothing you could do about it. We're $90,000 in the hole just because more people signed up. There's nothing we can do to control that. But in that 2%, there has to be priorities. And one of, like, And I only use this because Kathy's sitting right next to you, is the trees. We had cut, to keep that overall 2% or less, we had cut the tree budget a couple years, and especially that year, we spent no money on trees in that fiscal
right.
2000.
Well, we say
whatever.
You cut the tree budget,
yeah.
But actually there was a pretty sizable increase.
Right, but because we had...
But because of the recommendation...
Because of no... money being spent on the trees, we had a huge amount of unsafe trees in town
right.
that we needed to spend money on. So even though that you're supposed to overall keep it around 2%, that budget went up way high percentage, but
right.
overall dollars, I mean, we're talking about going from, you know, 20,000 to 30,000 or whatever it was. I mean, it was actually
right. more like
percentage.
40,000, I think.
Well,
right.
whatever, 40,000. I mean, you're 20,000 to 40,000.
Right.
I mean, you're it's 100% increase, but in actuality, it's only $20,000 difference. Whereas, just by adding extra kids from, teachers from the school, we went way over $90,000 more than what we budgeted for the health insurance. Right. So,
it's not like there wasn't a need. That's
right.
That's not
so,
great.
So
but
what
I'm saying is, it just puts.
Right, and so what we're going to do this year.
Negative light, that's
right,
all.
And what we're going to do this year, because both Trevor and Kip are new, so what we're going to do is start the budget process. We always say this every year, we're going to start the budget process early, but we're really going to start early. Doug is going to be on top of that. Mm-hmm. We're going to look at the priorities within it so that you will have the under 2%, budget. And that just seems to be like what we have to do every year, because we as long as I've been the selectman, we've always been under. I came on that year the Mitt Romney cut all the budgets. So I have never worked in a budget that we weren't cutting the budget.
Well,
so
what
we're going to pass on to you is what our priorities are, or what we feel is the priorities of the departments have priorities. And in the past, when Sean was something John Pachoric needed and Sean needed, and they between the two of them they decided that Sean could wait a year for something or whatever. The department heads decide themselves to give us a recommendation, and then we go to the finance committee with our priorities. And so what we will hopefully be able to work and explain to you better is what our priorities are, and you will have less you will not be criticized for this is what your recommendation is versus what has been requested. It will be,
I just like to make the process smoother,
right.
Make it a little bit smoother. And as Doug pointed out earlier, are we going to just keep spending our budget and just tread water? Or are we going to get serious and try to look at our budget and also find ways that maybe we can save some money
for future projects,
like stabilization fund that Doug has brought a couple of times here, which I think is an excellent idea. You hate to be spending down every year where now you're scrambling the next year. And it would be nice if we could somehow,
I absolutely agree with you. I just
that
wish that we would
put a little bit away for a rainy day, I guess.
Well, I was hoping this year we'd catch a break, but it doesn't look like
it. Hasn't rained.
Yeah, it hasn't rained, but it's coming.
I think it's rained a lot.
I think winter's coming.
But I think, from my point of view, it seems like, the highway garage, I'm going to pick on that again, is that the town really didn't spend any money for a long time. And, we were forced into a situation that we had to do something. In my opinion, it just got out of control. But to me, it's been that attitude that, the town didn't do things for so long, and now we're trying to catch up. But it seems to me that you can do these things, but you have to be more realistic on how you do it. And sometimes, and I'm going to pick on my neighbors, but you get people who are volunteering just as kind of I am here, and they get blindsided to what it costs. It's just like, this is what we want, this is what's good for the community, we need this, and bang, bang, bang. And they don't look at the other side of it, and that's the financial part of it. And it affects all of us. It's our seniors, it's our kids, and it's everybody. And we have to be able to draw a line and say, okay, you need new shoes, but you're not going to get Air Jordans, You need a pocketbook, but you're not going to get a Michael Kors, and that's
I'm
where
really
we seem.
Impressed.
Did you just
you
really name a brand name of pocketbook?
I know.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
That's on TV too.
That's terrific.
If my wife is still awake, she's laughing.
Yeah, she's impressed.
She's educated you on the name.
Oh, yeah.
Correct.
I think most people understand. You've got
You
need to spend money to run a town. There's
that's
no
right.
That's but right. As I've been saying for several years now, let's just spend it wisely.
Yeah. Exactly.
There's nothing wrong with having a little savings set aside
where things
come up and we're not behind the eight ball. At least we have something to fall back to. if nothing else, at least seed money.
And yeah. And that's so true. And one of the things that I'm going to try to do is to try to, I don't want to use the word educate. I want to try and tell the town that it's better to save money and have money in the bank, because when things come along and you have to spend the money, you're not, it's not like that desperate thing, almost like, oh, we have to have this now, so now we have to borrow money, and now we have to pay this price because we have to get it done. If you buy something, you know, just as you're going to need it, and it, you have some leeway to it, you can buy things so much cheaper, and that's the way it is in real life, too. Yeah. You know, if you don't buy food or whatever, then all of a sudden you have to go to the store. Well, last week the hamburger was on sale for half of what it is today, but I have to have it, so you buy it now. And that's where communities can save a lot of money, is just putting a little thought in advance of what you might need, but also saving money and doing with not the top line product going forward.
Right. You know? Every product doesn't have to be the Cadillac.
Right. Exactly.
Nothing wrong nowadays with the Chevy or Ford.
That's right.
Yeah, and it's
still expensive.
They are, but it's
still expensive. But, hey, I'm still driving an 03 and an 04.
Hey, I got you beat. I got you beat. Mine's a 99. Mine's a 99 from the last century.
See, there you go. Century, even.
Anyway, we got to go.
Any thoughts? Yeah, very much.
I have one thing, Carolyn, if I can show this to you.
And you can advise me as to whether or not I'm going to take this in open session. Pay attention to the date.
Oh,
because we can't do that unless we do this first.
I think we better.
I'm looking forward to this budget season.
Why don't we do this?
A lot of people aren't going like that.
It
is personal.
Negotiations with non-union staff.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. Then in that case, the only thing I have is a request for an executive session, very brief, for purchase, sale, or exchange of real estate, and for strategy in relation to negotiations with non-union personnel.
Make a motion to go into executive session.
Hi, Trevor McDaniel.
Oh, you got a second.
Oh, second.
You're going to vote? Okay.
Hi, Trevor McDaniel.
She'll lead us down this road. We'll get this. Don't worry.
Right.
We'll figure it out.
Put a leash on me.
Hi, Henry Camosa.
Hi, Carolyn Ness. Okay. Thank you, Chris. We're all set.